Yo, what up? We're here at the motherfucking Messy Crib for episode number 23 with motherfucking Jay Still. What up, brother?
What up, J-Raw? What up, Messy Fam? How y'all doing?
I love it. You know what? I don't know why I was like introduced him as Jay and I still went to Jay. I don't know why I go to your Instagram. Isn't that weird how you call a lot of people by their Instagram names?
Yeah.
It's like, what's up, J-Rod? It's like, you know, that's my alter ego and shit, but like, what's up, bro? Like,
it's
so fucking weird. But anyways, before we get into it too crazy, we got to go over our sponsors, everybody. Like I said, if you don't want to hear the sponsors, fast forward about 5 minutes, you know what's going on. But Proline Collision, we fucking love those guys over there. Jay, have you got any car accidents or any kind of insurance claims or, you know, about anything like that? You ever had any issues like that?
Not anything major, man. Just some hit and run shit.
Okay. How do your insurance? They take care of you?
Oh yeah. The insurance somewhere. They're beautiful, man.
For the most part, yeah. That's cool. So over at Proline Collision, guys, if you don't have great insurance coverage and these guys are like fucking you guys and you don't know what the fuck to do, hit them up. These guys will let you know what your insurance is supposed to do for you, what kind of coverage you should have, what you should be receiving, whether it's a fat ass check. I remember I got in a car accident. I had like a 2015 fully loaded Toyota Tacoma, and I bought it for like $16,000, and I ended up getting like a check for 19 G's. It was sick as fuck, bro. So, you know what I mean? You can get whatever car for 12, go to Proline, get a nice little $3,000 paint job. It looks like a goddamn race car. So, but yeah, Proline Collision, those guys are over there in Rancho, Cucamonga, real local out here in the Inland Empire. They do a great job. I know everybody that works there, so they could definitely hook it up and take care of you guys. So our other sponsor is Classick Sports. Super stoked to have those guys. I was talking to Jay before the podcast, and one cool thing that I forgot to mention, that those guys make like rash guards. And what are the yoga pants that you MMA fighters like train with?
Compression pants.
My bad. I'm over here trying to talk shit to Jay. To let you know, we haven't got too into it, but Jay does. He's like an MMA fighter. This guy will fucking strangle my neck. He will beat the fuck out of me. Like, I'm going to try to not talk so much shit, but everybody knows about the Messy Crib. And that's my best thing I do is just talk shit. But I know Jay's awesome. He fucking takes it. You know what? You know what's crazy about you guys? Well, not you guys. I'm not going to single out fucking MMA guys, but you guys are like the nicest people.
Right.
I think you let go of so much aggression or something like that, and you guys are just so respectful. Yeah. Well, not maybe not respectful, because some guys
get... A lot of them are really chill, though, level-headed, you know? You can get your hotheads, but for the most part, I mean, the people I fucking know are chill with, like, they're all fucking chill. Like, you wouldn't even know they fucking do it.
Yeah, I've never been to the gym. I mean, I've been to the gym a few times, but, like, as far as the guys I've met that you hang out with at the gym, like, at the parties and shit, they're all
fucking
chill.
Dorks,
they're all,
bro.
Yeah, they're all fucking cool. They're like nerds. Dorks, bro. Dude, it's fucking hilarious. I'm so excited to have you. But just a few more things from Classick Sports, guys. They make bags, batting gloves, bats, anything you could possibly think of, baseball. But they also do, like, tennis shorts. You know what I mean? I play tennis. You know, I do... I like to have long socks. They make long socks. They take care of all anything you could possibly think of. Jay, you play any sports growing up?
Nah, man. Just out in the park or with friends in the backyard.
What'd you do, wrestling?
Like, no, basketball, bro. I just played.
Okay.
At the park, you know.
Classic
street
sports.
Ball.
They make basketball jerseys, and if you do wrestling, I'm pretty sure they could do some kind of customizable gi.
Yeah.
They can pretty much print on anything. So hit up Classick Sports, guys. Classick, like sick at the end, sports on Instagram. But yeah, that's pretty much for our two sponsors.
They have a lot of footwear.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So then they probably carry mat shoes, so like the wrestler shoes and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I need to go pick some up. I'm going to check them out. They definitely need some.
Yeah, no, those guys are Classick Sports. They're right here locally, so whatever they don't have, we can get anything possible. So it's really awesome to have somebody that you could just give a phone call away hey, bro, this is what I need. Can we take care of it? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Where are they located?
Here out of, I believe he's going to kill me for this, but I believe Fontana, I don't know, North Fontana, guys, by the 210. Don't judge me. All right. Not by the 10 freeway. We're not going to talk about where like Jay stays. No, I'm just playing. But anyways, not our other sponsor, but, go check out the Messy Kids, guys. The Messy Kids official on Instagram. That's their music. Jay, what'd you think about our intro song right now? You're listening.
Dude,
I wonder.
It was nice, bro. It had fucking some good summertime vibes.
Like
I've been digging that, dude.
Vibe,
I've been listening
right?
to that a lot of music like that.
Hell yeah, that's fucking awesome.
And they're local?
Yeah. Those guys, the Messy Kids, those guys are right here out of Riverside. Some are out of LA, but there's about four or five dudes.
Dope, man. They're fucking want to see them.
Yeah, they talk about some real life shit. They could really relate because I'm not a big rap guy, but I could definitely fuck with them.
Yeah.
So everybody out there, go check out the Messy Kids TV on Instagram. I mean, go check out their YouTube and all that good shit. You guys know where to find them. So until then, let's get messy.
The Messy Crib.
Shut up! The Messy Crib is about to start!
Boy, was that awkward.
Got a messy motherfucker on the team. Got a messy motherfucker on the team. Cut the beat and hear him speak. Cut the beat.
Yo, what up, motherfucking Messy Crib listeners? I just want to say thank you to everybody out there that's listening. And today I have a gentleman on the podcast that I fucking love. This guy, I dear him. He's just an amazing fucking dude, a kind soul. And he's fucking a rage. We've partied a lot. We have a lot of memories together. So I'm excited to introduce him. His name is Jay Pinto. I want to introduce. Okay, who I got across from me is Jay PrimeTime. Is it Pinto or
Pinto, whatever, man?
I know. I'm over here acting like a fucking white Mexican California kid and shit. Right. Who the fuck is my best friend? Uriah Faber? What the fuck?
Yeah.
But anyways, how you doing, brother? I'm glad to have you on, man.
Man, I'm glad to finally come on, bro.
Hell yeah, it's been a long time coming. Yeah. Fucking our schedules are crazy, but we made this shit happen. I'm excited. As soon as I was like, all right, this relaunch is happening in June. Jay, what the fuck? What's your schedule like? We got to get you on, man. And so I'm excited. I'm really excited to jump into this, anything like that. So how can everybody find you? What you got going on right now?
Oh, man, if you want to connect with me, you can find me on Instagram. You can look me up, Jay Pinto, Jay PrimeTime Pinto. You could connect with me there, or Jsta5 on IG, or just Jay Pinto on Facebook. I don't really mess with Twitter. I'm on there, follow people, but I don't post much. Yeah, so
yeah, I like to retweet on Twitter. That's what I pretty much do. I don't really post anything, but I just retweet everybody. So I'm like that annoying guy that like just transfers information. But yeah, I feel like it's information.
But there's a lot of good information, right? That other people put out. Like, it don't all got to be mine, you know? Shit.
For sure. Any shout outs you got?
Oh yeah, man, definitely. my sponsor team. I just got done with the training camp. Unfortunately, the fight had to pull out. NutriShop in Fontana up in Sierra Lakes, man, I really want to thank them. They've hooked me up. They've helped me get my weight down because coming back into fighting. Well, not that I was away for long, but you know, I like to party. I like to eat.
Well, that's one thing I really want to talk about, because it's such a different life, because the weight cutting can get crazy when you get into those training camps, right?
Yeah. So I'm down fucking 50 pounds.
And that's not out of the norm. Like, that might, for somebody that, like, some of our listeners might not be too into MMA, so they don't really know too much, but 50 pounds, that's not out of the norm.
No. But normally, I got way heavier than I would normally even, like,
what's something normal?
Heavy.
20, 30 pounds?
25, 30 pounds, 35, and that's it. Then I always, like, I cut back down.
And how far is that out from, like, a fight? Like, how long is that camp when you start dieting?
Eight weeks of, like, hardcore dieting. But most of the time, I've been fortunate enough to know, like, before the 8 weeks out that, you know, I would be getting ready to go into a camp. So then I start cutting off certain things and start picking up my
soda,
workouts.
Beer.
Yeah, so this way it's a little bit easier. You know, I get the upper hand on
dude, I have so dropping. Much respect for you, because we'll be out fucking partying and shit like that, and I'll just be like, oh, Jay has a new fight. That's why he's partying and he's not drinking.
Yeah,
and you'll just
dude,
be turning
those
down shots, and I'm like, I don't know if it's hard for him, but he does it like a champ, like a stone face. I don't know if he's pissed.
Dude,
or
you
what.
Know what? If I didn't have a goal, then it's hard. You know, when you just try to go out and be sober, like, when all your friends are lit, and it's not just, you know, drinking with your friends, it's like I fucking have the dopest friends. Like, there's no one in my squad who's not, you know, this is just fun, bro. This, like, so anyways, NutriShop up in Fontana, they've helped me out a lot as far as you know, subs and stuff like that.
And I can imagine, like, how that can impact your cut, like having a sponsor that has your back.
Oh yeah,
you have all the everything you possibly need.
Easier, bro. I you know what, I really So here's one thing about mixed martial arts before I get on to the rest of my sponsors. But one thing about mixed martial arts is it's deceptive in the fact that a lot of people think it's a one man sport. If it was a one man sport, I'd be in the gym by myself. I would have nobody backing me. I have no training partners. I have a ton of training partners, and I've got a whole sponsorship team to help me get to my fight. But those 15 minutes that you see, or whatever, 25 minutes, 15 minutes that you see the athlete go out there and perform, his performance, you know, it's fueled by his team, his sponsors and stuff. So, you know, big ups to all my sponsors. So, yeah, NutriShot, man. You know what? I fucking love their BCAAs, man. Fucking, it makes water fun if you don't like water.
Hey bro, real quick for us fucking fucktards, can you explain what a BCA is? I don't know what a BCA
is. Bro, it's branched chain amino acids. They help with muscle retention. So say like if you're working out really hard and you want to burn fat, what they're gonna do is they're gonna help you retain so once your heart rate gets up to a certain BPM, you're burning fat and muscle. So when you when you're on the BCAAs and stuff like that, helps you retain the muscle versus burning both. So, you know, you can keep that muscle density.
For sure, that makes sense. Yeah, and a lot of people hate on steroids, but that's pretty much what steroids are for, right? Like recovery, like working out a lot, and it kind of we abuse them in America, of course.
Yeah.
But for our listeners, like they think, oh, you take steroids to hit home runs, but these guys are like, yeah, they're hitting home runs, and it does, of course, help that.
Yeah.
But it's mainly for when they're in the gym going
working
fucking
out
hard,
so they could get better. You know, like that's the thing about steroids, though. Is so it don't make you better; it enables you to get better. And I don't. I'm not preaching. Go do it. Our kids do it. I don't. Honestly, all natural. So,
performance. Oil. Yeah, we can tell when you get party, bro. We're all natural.
Yeah. So, anyways, it just helps with the muscle retention. But I've also picked up another really dope sponsor this camp. And you know what? The last couple of camps, I did it without sponsors. I was just doing it like I was putting my friends on like walkout banners, t-shirts and stuff like that. Just, you know, helping all my friends. It's just fun anyways, you know?
Right.
So anyways, I picked up, Health First Medical Weight Loss and Skin. They're out in, they got two locations. One's in Victorville. I'm not sure what the address is on either one, but look them up.
We'll put them in the show notes.
The local one to us would be in Redlands. So what I've been doing with them was I started taking some B12 shots, and they also gave me some little tablet pills of B12 to help with the energy.
Man, bro, I need to get some of that because.
Dude, it really helps, man. It really
helps.
Bro,
I'm a vegetarian, and there's, like, no B12. Like,
really?
That's one of the things they're like, oh, where do you get your B12 from, you fucking vegetarian?
Really?
So, honestly, though, I just been going fucking, like, wild, and I just like, oh, we'll see if something goes wrong with my body. It's been 3 years, and I've just been doing whatever the fuck I want. I'm still fucking fat. I'm falling apart.
Yeah.
But I'll be all right. But anyways, B12 shots, that sounds pretty awesome.
Yeah, dude. So, I got B12 shots, some other stuff called 5-HTP.
Oh, I heard of that.
Yeah,
I heard on Rogan's podcast. Yeah, he always throws that out.
Some feel good stuff. It's really good. And then some other stuff called Lipotrim, which fucking I'm a foodie. So when I start cutting back on food and stuff, that's the hard part because you know you binge and you crave and you can't get to, or at least I don't allow myself to like overeat even though I want to. So what this Lipotrim pill does is it after you take it, you're supposed to take it 15 minutes before your meals, which I just take it like before or during or after, it expands in your stomach. So it gives you like this bloated feeling, not like a crazy bad one, like where you're just like, oh, I'm gonna go puke, but to where you feel like you're full, like you're really satisfied. So that helped out a lot that camp. This last
damn, that's pretty fucking intense.
Yeah, dude, it's
that's
fucking,
some real technology shit
dude,
right
it's
there.
Dope as fuck, bro. Like, okay, so and it's all natural.
Imagine if Chuck Liddell had that back in the day.
I don't know how long this stuff's been around, bro, but he should have been on it. Honestly, if you're a foodie and you want to cut back on food, jump on this stuff. Like, go to any place.
Does it help alcohol? Because I think that was his problem.
I don't
know. It seems like he had a turtle in his stomach.
We should try it out, bro. yeah, dude. So they were big this camp. And then one of my longtime sponsors and friend, Mike from Total Aggression, check out his clothing. He does all my t-shirts and actually all my fight wear. So t-shirts and shorts. Let me see, Mike Robert from he was with Remax. I forget where he went to. He just changed companies. He sells homes and stuff. Oh, Robert with Realty Masters and Associates. Check him out. I feel like I'm missing somebody.
I know of one, but I'm going to wait and see if you don't talk about him.
Oh, fuck. Oh, no. Drawing a blank. So I got them. Mike. I don't know, bro.
Well, if you forget any sponsors, next time we'll remember you guys, because Jay's going to be on the fucking podcast many times. But I think one of your biggest sponsors, I kind of want to hear the story. Let's jump into it now that we're through with your, like, talking about that. Aguirre's Fighting System.
Oh yeah, bro. That's my, yeah. Obviously, yeah, you know what? They do sponsor me. I probably should look at them like a sponsor because they do put a lot of stuff out there for me. But, man, you know what? That's my home, bro. I'm there at that place more than I am my own house, more than I am anywhere else, man. Like, it's not a bad thing, but I live there. You know what I mean? I'm there for sure, in the mornings for sure. With clients, working out in the mornings, working out in the afternoon, then
and
teaching.
It's cool
because
you love, yeah, you're there, yeah, all the time. You love it. Where else would you want to be? That's where you spend your time. You love it.
Nowhere, man. Maybe if I could take the gym and put it on the beach somewhere, you know, something like that. But it's dope, bro. It's home.
So before we talk a little bit about the gym, Aguirre's Fighting System, your coach,
Franklin Aguirre,
do you mind giving us a little bit of background? A little bit, I would love to have him on the podcast, hopefully. So, you know, we're talking about a Messy Crib on the Road episode, I think it would be great if we bought it to the Aguirre Fighting System. That would be sick as fuck.
That'd be really cool, man. Shout out to Franklin Aguirre. He's like my father. He really is, man.
Damn, everybody. Jay's about to cry right now, guys. Like, look at, I'm just playing. I'm just fucking around. I love it, though.
For reals, man. He's a good mentor, good man in general, just to start with, you know, not including, I'm just saying his coaching aspect. You know, he's a good person, very transparent. You know, he's one of those people that if you need to talk to somebody, definitely there for. He has an open door, but his martial arts background is actually pretty phenomenal as well. He's been doing martial arts shit forever.
Bro, real quick, this is the Messy Crib, so I want to hear all the messy shit you heard about, like, Aguirre. I want to hear about some of his fights. Like, I want to hear about some of the dudes he's knocked out, some of the dudes he's choked out. Maybe when he's learned a lesson, you know what I'm saying? With messy shit.
Yeah. Some messy shit about Franklin. I don't know, man. He's fucking, the dude's angelic, bro. I don't know if there's anything.
Dude, I fucking love
him.
The guy. I know. You know, I'm like oh my God. That's what I say about fighters. Like, dude, you guys are the prime example right there. Yeah. He's the biggest, scariest looking fucking. I don't know if he's Russian, but he looks like a crazy Russian fucking killer.
Yo, dude, check this out. So he's about, what, like 6'2", 6'3", I think.
but he walks around like he's 6'5".
Man, check this. So we always joke around about his calves because he has the biggest calves ever. And just tonight I left the gym, we were talking, and he was telling us he measured his calves today. Take a guess.
Well, Hulk Hogan's pythons are like 32 inches, so I'm guessing like 18.
His calves? Nah.
What, 20?
21.
What? Holy
bro,
shit.
He's got some. So on Yelp, someone posted, I won't say her name, but someone posted, don't be intimidated by him, and describing him, but part of the description was, don't be intimidated by these cantaloupes he has on the back of his calves. Or as calves is funny stuff. But anyways, yeah. So he trained for a long time. He's originally from Costa Rica, where he was training like traditional martial arts.
What's his nationality?
He's a Costa Rican.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's what they're called, right?
I don't know.
No, yeah, that's what they're called. But so he came out here and took up jiu-jitsu.
Okay. And, well, real quick, before we talk about what people call them, like Costa Ricans, like after like I found out and I started calling people what from El Salvador, what people call them, I just stopped saying that shit. You know what I'm saying? I would get so many people. You know what I'm talking about?
I think I have an idea.
Okay.
Starts with an S.
Yeah. Audience out there.
Ends with a ya.
Yeah. If you don't know what the fuck we're talking about, you could Google what do they call people from El Salvador, and I'm pretty sure that shit's gonna pop up. So that's why I stopped. Like, Costa Ricans, eh, that sounds about right. All right, cool. we're gonna go there.
It's safe.
But that's cool. So what did he learn out in Costa Rica? What did he start out there before jiu-jitsu?
Dude, I think it was like taekwondo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I think it was
that's
taekwondo.
Cool.
So then he, when he came out to the States, he was doing jiu-jitsu and sambo. Jiu-jitsu and sambo. So his lineage, if you're familiar with grappling, it's from judo Jean LaBelle. That's where he was doing, that's where he got his sambo and stuff like that from the highest end. Now they're team highest end.
Well, that's massive. You hear like the best of the best talking about him.
Yeah, man. He's the best judo practitioner in the States, probably in the world. I'm not really big on stats and that kind of stuff.
No, I feel it.
Yeah, so he did that. He's a 3-time sambo national champ, which is pretty big. And then there's a it used to be called Grappler's Quest, a pretty prestigious grappling tournament out here in the States. And he's had that light heavyweight title. And I think he had to cut like 30 pounds to get to light heavyweight or something like that, because his coach wanted to compete at heavyweight and just told him, hey, I'm going to compete at heavyweight. So they weren't going to compete against each other. So Franklin had to cut 30 pounds in like one night or some stupid shit.
That's a kind of a crazy thing. When, like, have you ever had the issue where you had to fight? No, well, you wouldn't fight against your own guy, right? In your own camp?
Nah.
Have you ever fought a friend that you didn't know, maybe?
Nah, man. You know what? I don't think I can do that unless it's like for a lot of money and we're already in the big show, you know?
Right, I feel it.
Yeah, but other than that, because there's so many people to fight at this level, you know, like I'm not trying to fight any of my friends.
See, that's me thinking like a fucking idiot. Like, I'm gonna hit up my homie, that's my rival. Hey, bro, you train, right? All right, you're gonna be on the other side of the cage, bro. Like,
yeah, it's different. Like, if they're just an acquaintance, though, like if you've trained with them and stuff. I fought somebody who was out of one of my friends' gyms, and that one felt a little weird at first. But you know, once I got in the cage, it didn't feel weird no more. Actually lost anyways, but
so before we start talking about your fighting career, I'd like to know anything else about Franklin?
Man, he's had the gym here forever. He's a third degree black belt in sambo and jiu-jitsu. He's got black belt from I forget what big ass organization, like some martial arts organization and like kickboxing and stuff too.
So at the Geary Fighting System, you guys train literally all MMA.
Yeah, man. We cover Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, kickboxing, mixed martial arts, obviously. Judo, we do wrestling, and sambo. So, yeah, there's not a lot of people who do sambo.
That's dope. So what do you coach, and what do you I know you coach a lot of kids in different kind of classes. What are you, or like all age groups, or what?
Yeah, man, we're pretty open with the age. We start some kids out as young as 4.5.
Wow, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah, you know what, with us, it's just as long as they have some type of attention span, we'll work with the kids, you know. So we try them out before, and then we give their parents an honest opinion. Now, the fucked up thing about that, though, is, you know, when they get there for the first week, they're on their best behavior. So you could imagine what it's like 6 months down the road.
And you
road,
become
bro.
Uncle Jay and shit.
Yeah,
huh?
And these little dudes, you know, they're dope, man, but they can be a handful at times, you know. So yeah, we teach kids there. We start them out as early as 4, and honestly, if you're willing and want to come in, it don't matter how old you are, you know, just come in and work out. So yeah, whatever age.
How often do you teach at the, like, do you like twice a day, or like does it get pretty?
I have 3 classes a night, and then depending on clients determines on how many hours I'm teaching a day. Sometimes it's like 4 hours, sometimes it feels like it's 10 and it's only 8.
No, I yeah, feel like I yeah, can imagine so, how intense it can get pretty good, because I like to talk about this stuff, because a lot of MMA fighters, when they go back to the gym, most of them are teachers, most of them, you know, they're the guys that people look up to and shit like that. You know, you just see them on TV, you see them at their big fights, but you don't know what goes on around in, you know, in the background.
Yeah, and it's a way too for them to, you know, not have to work. like a regular 9-to-5, you know, fucking construction or something like that. There's a lot of fighters who do, and hats off to them, man. But it's hard. I tried doing it, and it was hard.
That's rough, right? To follow your dreams or do something that, you know, you want to do. And especially if, like people that go to college, they work at the college, it just makes everything a lot better.
Yeah, because everything's just right there, man. You know, you get out of work and walk right down to your class, you know? So I did that for a while. I was working at Kaiser, probably around this when we met, too, a little bit after we met.
How long have we known each other?
I think 2011.
It might be that long.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's been a while.
Yeah. Feels like a long time, huh?
For real.
Even longer.
I'm about to turn 31. Oh.
Yeah, wait. Bro. Happy fucking birthday.
I'm about. Oh, yeah. I just feel a lot older. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Actually, I feel older. So, you know, it's weird because when you turn 30, it's not a big deal. You just turn 30. You're cool.
I couldn't wait to be 30, bro. Like, I couldn't wait to be 30, man. Couldn't wait.
And then when you turn 31, though, it's a whole different story. You're like, oh.
Like, shit, I'm in the middle now, bro. Oh, like,
that sounds a little older than 30. Like, right. I'm not in my 20s more. Yeah. Oh, shit. Right. I'm going to start a podcast about the messy crib. And, you know, we're going to see where it goes. No, I'm still glad to be able to follow my dreams, man. Like, yeah. I look at you, brother, and I fucking love you. And I can't wait to have you on because you're so honest. You're such an open book that we could explore your life and we could see the type of shit that you're going through, the type of shit that you've gone through and where you're about to go. I can't even wait to get into your past about when you were a kid and growing up and all that good shit. But yeah. But that's what the Messy Crib's all about. And what really excites me about like teaching kids, because I coach a lot of baseball and I've coached high school and shit like that, and teaching different age groups is you kind of I don't really know like any real master or anybody really that knows something. Is that you're kind of always learning, right? So yeah. I can imagine how much you learn from these people that come and you're like, oh shit. Like, do you ever have any like wake, like blinking moments where you're like, oh shit, like from these people that you coach or cheat, you know?
Yeah, yeah. All the time, bro. The kids though, like it's crazy, you know, watching them just evolve and how much they know nowadays. I feel like I was a stupid ass. Well, like maybe a little challenged compared to the kids nowadays, bro. You know, and I don't know how long you've been coaching, but I've been coaching since 2006.
That's when I graduated. So that's when I graduated. 2007, too. The year after I graduated, that's when I started coaching. That's awesome. But baseball's a lot different than mixed martial arts. We do one thing, and it's a game. Everybody knows it. Mixed martial arts is the newest, probably the fastest rising sport,
yeah,
I would say.
Yeah, it's the fastest.
Because let's think
sport.
About it. It's only been around for maybe, what, 20? Okay, people that have known maybe 20 years. People, when's the first fucking real UFC where people? Most people didn't even see that.
You know what? I think you know, a lot of people were turned off by it because it was... It looked really brutal, you know.
I used to call it human
cockfighting.
Gladiator fighting. Yeah, yeah. Like it's like modern day gladiators. Like, yeah. They don't got no weapons, no fucking tiger, just two dudes.
Yeah.
Cockfighting.
And then they lock them in a cage too. Like, I think it wouldn't have been as I don't think it would have looked so bad if they would have been in like an open platform. Like Kumite.
Right,
you know,
right,
I mean,
right.
It wouldn't look that bad.
And
but when
like,
you put anybody in a cage, that looks fucking
yeah. Anybody that's, you know, obviously now that more people are educated about it, it's like, oh, it's a legit sport. It's on ESPN. Yeah. Fucking, can I clap for that? Like,
right, round of
like,
applause.
MMA's on ESPN. Like, that's national. Yeah. Oh, that's fucking world coverage. That's fucking amazing. And it's cool because it's been around in like in Thailand, and I can imagine how many centuries it's been around.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, all the aspects of it have been around forever. You know, wrestling's been as long as fucking probably dudes have been alive. You know,
for sure. You've always been you see dogs, animals, they be wrestling around. Bears be wrestling around.
Yeah,
you know, that shit's
right.
Been around since fucking
yeah, forever, dude. So you know,
so you think about MMA 20 years ago. You have like the Gracies that come in and do jiu-jitsu and just take these guys out. Like Chuck Liddell's, if you're a real good stand-up fighter, you can knock dudes out.
Yeah.
You talk about kids these days coming in. Dude, they've seen all that.
Yeah.
So they want to do all of it. So now you legit have mixed martial artists.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
There's not really like a Damian Maia that's a Brazilian jiu-jitsu guy anymore. You know what I mean? You got like your – I think of like a Rory McDonald where you're just completely like now. I don't know.
The
he found God
package,
and now.
Man.
Yeah, I don't know. He found God though and I don't know. But
you know what? Like – one thing about Rory McDonald, though, is so when he started, when he first came onto the scene, was he was a single dude, right? He was a single dude.
They say she'll change you.
Yeah, man. I have a really good friend who's fucking one of the best at fighting. Like, really, he mixes everything really well together. Does good. I've watched him grapple. I've watched him stand up with really big names and put in mad work on them. And when he goes to fight, he freezes up because he had lost the fight. He got head kicked, and he was, I believe he had just had his first kid and was about to get married. And after that, it just kind of took his fire out. So that changes you, you know, like you go in there, you're eager as a young buck, you know, got all this testosterone and, you know, it's only you have to worry about. But then when you got mouths to feed and you're getting punched in the head and you're getting bruised and kicked and you got to go do whatever you got to do, you know, it changes you.
I can imagine, bro. After you getting head kicked in the head and getting knocked and getting any knocked out period after that, and then you have kids, it's like, oh, I remember how that I remember that.
Yeah.
I can imagine how it happened before leading up to that. And then once you get knocked out, I can't wait to get into that, because like at the feeling after, like, fuck, like you hear, like, I've been listening to podcasts for years, fucking post fight shows, and you just see how these guys, they just feel so destroyed. But it's like, dude, like I look at them like, oh my God, I can't believe you went in there. Fucking, yeah. I'm like bowing to these motherfuckers.
Man, you know what? That's a crazy thing too, is like how people just go in there, man. You know, like, think about this. If you told the average person, like, hey, in 2 weeks, show up right here, I'm gonna have someone else come and fight. They're not gonna show up to fight.
Even if there is money on the line.
Yeah. Let alone put their body through all the stuff that, you know, training requires.
Okay, let's jump into that real quick. That's a great segue. So a lot of people are like, oh, they're gonna fight a lot, but these 8 week training camps, like, it's not no bullshit. You're pretty much like, the fighting legit. Is like, oh, I reached the milestone, I'm here, like, this is a bonus, right?
Because yeah.
Like, I can imagine, like, so what goes on? Because I know you had to pull out because something happened, but I mean, mental health is huge these days, and not just the technology, but just the awareness around concussions. And how I just heard the other day, somebody that blacks out getting drunk is equivalent to getting knocked out.
Really?
Yeah. Like, I heard that, like, there's some part in your brain that, like, I don't know, whatever. But, you know, we don't know exactly what happens, but I heard that's pretty, you know. So talk us a little bit about your training camp and how it went and what everything that happened. What's the kind of normal thing you're looking at? How much what I really am interested in is, like, how much sparring does an actual person do? Because I know you got a concussion, so it's like, I'm thinking, like, I know Robbie Lawler back in the day, he used to spar like crazy, and now he don't spar at all.
Yeah.
So, like, what's something like that? What's like a training camp for you guys?
For me, it's a lot of honestly, it's a lot of grappling and kickboxing. I do a ton of sparring and a lot of grappling. I know there's some people who don't like to spar at all. Like, example, like you just mentioned, Robbie Lawler, like, supposedly he just hits pads. And I think Jake Shields too might have been another fighter who don't spar. And I get it. I get it. You know, you don't want to take damage. So I get it. But I do sparring a ton, honestly. Maybe like 4 or 5 times out of the week I'm sparring, and it's not no 20-30%. It's anywhere between, like, I would say 60 and like 80. It's about 60-80%.
Like, thank God, because I remember hearing stories about, like, the cheetah box days, like, back in, like,
Dudes knocking each other out.
Yeah, like, Wanderlei Silva, and you still see Shogun getting knocked out, and he goes out there, like, he don't even care.
Dude,
like, he's been knocked out a million
such
times.
Such a monster, too. I heard this crazy story about Wanderlei and Shogun. So, story was, I guess a stray dog walked into the gym, and they both wanted the dog.
Oh, I love it already.
Yeah, they both wanted
Brazilians.
The dog, bro. Stray dog walks into the gym, and they both wanted the dog. So they came up with the plan, and whoever knocked the other guy out got to keep the dog. So they started fighting, and then story goes, the next thing you know is Shogun wakes up, and he sees Vanderlei petting the dog, holding the dog, taking the dog home. Dude, yeah, those dudes are crazy, man. But, yeah, so fight camp for me was a lot of grappling in the morning. So it would be so my training would start about 8:30, a little bit before 8:30, and it would be just a quick warm up, and then get some really good hard rounds of sparring, and then start grappling, and then it's about 45 minutes of technique, and then 45 minutes live. Sometimes there's two black belts on the mat, sometimes there's three. After that, I go home, rest, I'd hydrate, eat, get back to the gym at 2:30. Run between 2 to 4 miles for my warm up. For my warm up, and then do about 25-35 minute circuit, and then another 30 minutes of live rolling or sparring. Then after that, it was just like technical classes. So then I do technical class at night, which would be jiu-jitsu, gi or no gi at night for another hour. And then some MMA stuff at night. So sometimes it was just sparring, like kickboxing sparring. Other times it'd be like ground and pound stuff or drills or doing conditioning for it.
For sure. Yeah.
Super intense, man. A lot of work.
So this, like, during these 8-week camps, you're doing like 2 to 3 a days.
Oh, yeah, man.
Like, you're going, like, 2 hours at a time, then you're taking, like, whatever break or whatever, and then you're going, like, another 2 or 3 hours, and, you know, it can get, I can imagine.
Yeah, I was training between probably 5 and 7 hours a day. Yeah, this last camp.
And when you see people that either get knocked out quick, or you see somebody that ends it quick, or ends on an eye poke, or you see something, and these guys are so, and people are like, oh, they're, like, you hear people booing and shit like that, and it's like, dude, you don't realize that these motherfuckers just went through the past 8 weeks.
Yeah, man. Yeah. I heard one of my buddies, his name's Joe Stevenson, pretty popular guy.
I have some cool stories about that guy.
Oh, yeah, right? Anyways, one day I heard him say, you know, others are entertained by what we do, because that's what it is, man. It's entertainment for people. You know, for us, though, it's a challenge. You know, it's a challenge, and it's probably one of the I don't know, man. One of the hardest things to do. You know?
I'll say, you guys are humble as fuck. It's the fucking hardest thing to do in the world. Yeah. You're going to stand there and say, beat the shit out of that guy, and he's well-trained, and the other guy has the same fucking goal?
Yeah.
That's the hardest fucking job. That's the craziest thing. It's fucking, it's nuts. You guys are a little crazy. You guys are all a little nuts. You guys are all a little nuts.
It takes a little.
Shit, I go sing karaoke and I start fucking, my legs start shivering and shit, bro. I start getting all nervous and
shit. Yeah, bro. Hey, by the way, we need to go fucking.
Bro, I won't go with you karaoke. No more. You sang Valerie and you just killed it. All the bitches got all wet. Their panties dropped. And I was like, well, Jay's getting late tonight. I guess I'm not.
Not hardly, bro.
No, I'm excited. Yeah, you know what was awesome? The last time we went to go sing karaoke, I dropped Molly. That was pretty cool.
Did you? How was that?
It was pretty, I don't know, it was a little weird because I was doing Molly in a karaoke bar, so I'll let you guys' imaginations work. But anyways.
We are grinding up on the table.
Is that a boner or is that just my wooden stool?
All right, shit. Oh, that's cool, man.
But yeah, man, let's jump into this a little bit, because I do get nervous when I go on stage sometimes. Like, I heard Joe Rogan or somebody talked about if you stand like Superman pose and you take like 30 breaths for like a minute or something like that, it helps you.
Really?
And really, I do yoga, and I go into cold water, like Aubrey Marcus, shout out to his podcast and his book. I do like a good minute of cold fucking water after my normal shower.
Mm-hmm.
And it really been helping my breathing and shit. Like William Hoff, like, people think I'm fucking crazy, but you could like literally create heat within your body by breathing.
Yeah.
So that's exactly what I was talking about.
So some breathing techniques.
Yeah. I forgot what the original thing I was talking about. Right. Why I even started talking about breathing. Oh, so nervous. Karaoke. Being nervous. Right. So I started doing those little fucking Superman techniques and breathing, and it really helped. So how do you go into, like, before your name's called, before you even walk out there, when you're fucking training, you got your gloves, you're already all padded up, you're ready to go, What's going through your fucking head before you walk me through all that? Because I have a million questions.
Yeah.
Bro. You know, I love you to death, and you're like one of my good friends. Yeah, yeah, so yeah. I feel like I can go in. Like, I have I have some other boy, like some MMA fighter I met, and I was like, oh, this guy's cool, fucking la la. But I feel like I couldn't, you know, I couldn't quite go into like all the annoying questions that a fan would ask.
Yeah.
But with you, bro, I feel like you're open book, and I really appreciate you and shit like that. So when you're backstage in the fucking green room or in the fucking room, do you ever see your opponent back there?
Sometimes it depends on how the promotion's set up. Sometimes you go to like some really nice fancy promotions, and then other times you're in a tent somewhere. Dude, hey, so there is a promotion. I forget the name of it, but they used to call the spot where they would be fighting the chicken coop.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, dude. You ever watch Here Comes the Boom?
Hell yeah, I love that. That was a great movie.
So where he talks about, I forget the line, but it was something about bottom level MMA is where they start. It's like one of those promotions, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, everybody's got to start somewhere. So you know, you'll hear people on Sure Dog, their editors, writers, whatever those people are, people even online complaining about certain organizations because they don't seem too legit like other places. Well, sometimes, you know, the best fighters come out of there, man, like Rampage, Riot Faber. There's a million fighters that came out of places
like that.
Some rough-ass
places, some messy-ass places.
Some messy-ass places, bro, for real.
But I mean, like, Here Comes the Boom. Like, if I was fat and I was a heavyweight and I fucking fell and that shit broke, I mean, like.
Yeah. Oh, dude, that's pretty funny. I fought out of this one spot. I don't know. You might have been there, man. I think you might. I'm not sure if you were
there. We're just going to say, yeah. Like, I was a good friend and supported you that
time. Dude, so that day is outdoor fight, and they have a canopy over the whole arena. Saboba Casino. So anyways,
you gotta love Indians, right? Like, dude, open on these fights. Yeah. People want to see them, open them on.
It's fun fighting there, dude. I love fighting. And when you're done fighting in the cage, you know, you might fight in the stands, dude, in two fights in one night. But anyways, one day, we were going to the fight show, and I was riding in the car over with my coach and some friends and stuff. And anyways, it was raining that day, and the canopy isn't like a full solid canopy, like it's really porous. So the mat, we were all scared about the mat being wet. And then one of my other boys had told me a story about another fighter who fought on a slippery canvas. And so I was like, you know what? I'm down to do it. Like, I'm all for the experience. Let's go, you know? Like, what's the worst that can happen? You know, you're going to fall on the mat anyways if anything happens. So went in, took the fight anyways. And, dude, it was a fun time, man. Ended up winning that fight by knockout in the third round against a really solid dude, man. So that went well, and then they dried the mat off, so it wasn't slippery and stuff like that. So yeah,
that's dope. At least they, you know.
Oh, but anyways, the pre-fight jitters, man. You know what? They hit me hard, man. They hit me hard. I'm not gonna lie. I would say about 80% of the time, after weigh-ins, after I see my opponent, when I'm at home, in bed, fucking. Right before I go to sleep, I hear something that always goes through my mind. It's like, call coach and tell him you got a fever. You can't fight tomorrow. That's how fucking nervous I am. Like, it just sits there, and it just fucking, man, the butterflies, they're not those pretty little things fluttering around. These things are fucking stressing you out, man. You know, but so normally I just do things that fucking would keep me happy, whether it's
I see a lot of music and stuff. Yeah, I was just about to say, I see a lot of MMA fighters that have their headphones in while they're sparring, and it seems like they're trying to just calm. Is that what you're trying to do? Is like get to it calm?
Sometimes it's, you know, motivation. You know, you throw your favorite song on. Some dudes are listening to some aggressive stuff. Other people, just some chill shit, you know? Whatever it is to take your mind, get it off of that nervous feeling, those butterflies and stuff. So yeah, that's the night before. And then I don't even set my alarm. I just wake up whenever my body's good to go. And then I'll eat whatever. Well, I'll clean, but you know, something clean that I like or enjoy. Then get down to the gym, meet up with my team, and then ride over. And then on the ride over, I'll catch butterflies. You know, I'll get nervous and stuff again. And then conversation, though, you know, it's dope about my team is they're really good at getting your mind off of that that nervous feeling, you know. So they're pretty dope about that.
I can imagine they would come in a lot, right, during that time.
Yeah. Yeah, man, it's
like that's your support system right there.
Yeah, it's dope, you know, because you went all camp with them, and then, you know, it's the next thing you know, you're feeling all good and stuff, going up to the fight, and they're there in your ear, you know, just reminding you put in all the hard work and stuff like that. That's always a big help. In the dressing room is when it hits again, you know, after I get, I kind of catch the, get nervous again when I start getting my hand wraps, or getting them wrapped and stuff. I'll get them, and so I put my headphones on and just fucking zone out right there. Then once I got them wrapped, I'll fucking just chill a little bit. Hitting pads takes it away. And then when it's like the fight before, two fights before, when they stage, like when I know they're calling my name to get staged, then I'm like, oh shit, like I'm doing it again. Here we go. Let's do it, you know. And then walking out, they kind of start going down, and then, you know, fucking hop in the cage and they all go away, man. Like it's game time.
I can imagine. I'm such a pussy. The only thing I compare it to is like going on a roller coaster.
Ooh, like you know those time. Big drops. You yeah. know those big drops.
It's like you it's, know some shit's it, right around the corner.
And it don't go away, bro. It's like being on that big drop for hours and it don't go away. It just stays there, man.
I can imagine. We talked about how I really honestly think it's the hardest thing to do in the world. Now imagine having the jitters to do that.
Yeah, right. Like in front of people.
Like I would never be able to I could never explain that. But to try to put yourself in like a fighter's shoes and stuff like that, it's fucking amazing.
Yeah, man.
It literally trips
yeah.
me out.
Yeah, if you're interested in someone who's pretty great at articulating. And a really famous guy who did it was Donald Cerrone. He talks about being nervous, you know. That's and he's pretty fucking accurate. That's how I feel too. I don't know if every fighter feels like that, but I do.
I wasn't gonna bring up the story, Jay, but now that you brought up Donald Cerrone, and those are the two fucking fighters that everybody fucking knows, and we will, especially right now, Donald Cerrone's fucking right? on a tear.
Dude, he's making history, bro. What is he's got the most fights, right?
I think and I some other say, like, stuff the most too. Wins in the UFC.
Yeah, man,
like he's, in the octagon.
He's such a cool dude, man. Like he's the most humble dude. Even before.
That's what I'm saying. Okay, you know? So let's talk about this story because you were there.
Yeah.
So what was that? Was Joe Stevenson's league, right?
Yeah. What's the name of his league? Oh, California Fight League. Shout out to them, bro. They're honestly, I would have to say my. Favorite amateur fight shows to take amateurs to do the fighters right. It's local for me, and it's just, dude, it's a good production, and they're on fucking like NBC Sports or some NBC Sports. They just got a contract, so not even professional fighters are fighting NBC Sports or
that's MMA.
Know,
it's taking the world by storm,
and they're putting these amateurs, which is fucking amazing for exposure. So like if I have a guy that goes out there and kicks ass and someone sees him in fucking wherever the Midwest or on the East Coast, and they like, you know, hey, let's look this guy up, let's get our product out there, then my guy is getting product from, you know, it's great exposure, man. I really like that show. They're doing a good job. Shout out to them. They got a show August 3rd up in Victorville.
Okay, nice. Yeah, I'll probably head out there.
Yeah. Oh yeah, so anyways, yeah, the California Fight League, they bring out big name fighters, Misha Tate, the Nightmare, so Diego Sanchez.
That's my favorite fighter of all time.
Really?
I wish I had a lot of stories. I only got like 3 stories about him.
Have you met him?
No, I've never met him.
Really? I've met him twice.
I've interacted with him on Facebook and shit like that, like commenting on
his shit.
Like
your stuff, bro?
I'm a fanboy, yeah.
How does that feel? That feels fucking great, huh?
Bro.
You screenshot it, send to your friends like, yo, look at this
and
shit.
Diego,
you like my shit?
Diego's kind of like, I don't know how people perceive him, but I've known him his whole career since The Ultimate Fighter.
Uh-huh.
And like that's when that's why Joe Stevenson and him became my cousin, Kenny, his favorite fucking fighter is Joe Daddy. And I was like, I can't choose the same fucking guy. So I was like, I'll choose Diego. But they were both the winners of, you know, of the Ultimate Fighter one.
One and two.
Yeah.
Diego is one, Joe is two.
Yeah, and so fucking it was so fucking epic, bro. And but to talk about that is because Donald Cerrone, when he was he just taking pictures, publicity,
yeah,
and stuff like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, he was there just for the fans. You know, they brought him out for the fans.
Yeah, and so I remember we were taking pictures, and he was, like, about to leave, and everybody was gone. I was like, hey, man, I think you mentioned the country bar in Victorville.
Yeah.
And I was like,
Gators. It was Gators.
No, it was
Gators. Was it Gators? Yeah, it was Gators. We were at Gators.
Fuck, I completely forgot.
Yeah, you're thinking about the strip club that they were all trying to go to. Yeah, so anyways, Joe Stevenson, he's one of my coaches. My coach used to train him when Joe was a younger kid. So I think he went into the gym when he was about 11 or 12. So Franklin was, and Joe's told me himself, a father figure to him. So, you know, Franklin's my coach. I'm going to take advantage and, you know, catch whatever plugs I can from him. So anyways, you know, Joe's really good dude, great friend. So we're hanging out with him after the fights, and he told us where they were going to go hang out. So go to the bar, and we're chilling with, you know, two of the dopest fighters ever. Dude, it was a good time with Donald, though, man. It was a real good time with Donald.
Great.
You know?
There was one point where he was dancing Suavemente, took the beer out of my hand, had it. He's like, hey, I got you, man. Don't worry about it. He just took it out of my hand like we were best friends.
Yeah.
My beer, and I was like, perfect. I was like, I'm about to jack this cup and take it home.
Right? Sign it. Dude, do you remember when we had him chugging out of the fucking pitcher?
Yeah, bro. Shit got wild. Yeah, like, when I tell people we party with Joe Daddy Stevenson and fucking Donald Cerrone, they don't understand we fucking partied with them. Like, most people, like, one time I went to a club Sutro in Newport.
And waved to him.
Yeah, Rampage was there, Rob Deerdick, and somebody else was there. And I was like, yeah, I party with those guys. But they're in their own little area, shit like that.
Party
but
with
this
them.
Time, dude, Donald was like, yeah, we'll go together.
Yeah,
let's go hang out. Then we show up at the same spot. And then how often does that happen where you show up and it's like, oh, shit's not going to go through. Somebody's going to go there. They're going to go that way. And
well, the fun part about when we left the bar was, you know, he comes out and he's fucking capping on me, which is pretty funny. He's lucky he's bigger than me. And then we were about to leave, and we see him, and we're like, I wonder what he's gonna do. Like, he's not from out here. So we're like, hey, Donald, what you doing after, man? Like, let's go to the strip club or some shit. You know, we're just trying to party with Donald. And then he's like, nah, man, I'm gonna come over to I'm not gonna say her name. He's like, I'm gonna come over to whatever. And we're thinking like, oh, it's probably a strip club too, you know, like whatever. It sounds like stripper name. So anyways, he's like, follow my manager. So we're following his Cadillac, and next thing you know, residential street, and we're like, oh, he's talking about a house party. And we're at a house party with Donald till fucking, you know, forever too. And that shit was just,
what the
cracking.
Fuck, I didn't get that cool. See I'm
oh
just
yeah
like,
you didn't go to the house party, huh?
And I was just about to say, like,
oh,
I'm not a cool MMA
man.
Fighter like you guys, you know what I mean? But just it wasn't meant to be.
How did that not happen?
I don't know. I really don't remember anymore. Like, I don't remember what happened.
I don't either.
I might have got just too trash.
Maybe we just
out.
Parked in different areas of the parking lot at the bar, and that's what happened.
That's probably what happened. I have no clue.
Shit.
It's cool, bro. I understand you guys.
I feel
I'm
like
just a regular, I'm just a regular pedestrian, just a fucking fanboy.
Nah, bro. Once you're fam, bro. You know.
Nah, that's cool, man. That was
behind.
One of the best experiences I've ever had.
That was fun.
But yeah, Joe Daddy Stevenson, I watched him growing up, and he was one of my favorite fighters of all time. So it was really cool to interact and actually have a conversation. So people that don't know too much about Joe Daddy Stevenson, he has a lot of kids, right? And he's like the most, like he's like one of the most, like, he gives a lot away, you know, not to the community, not away, but like he just gives a lot. He's just a real caring fucking dude.
Yeah, man, he really is. He's genuine, you know, very helpful when it comes to training and the ins and outs, you know. Really cool dude, and dude, he's been there, done that, so that's always really cool, you know. Really cool, man. One day when I was just going ham, like going out and partying a bunch, and I'd been training with him, well, not like as his student and stuff, but you know, training with him or his guys, and I was just partying a bunch, and he hit me up and was like, yo, what's going on, like, what's going on with all the partying, like, kind of telling me to, like, check myself with the partying and, like, recalibrate, you know.
Yeah, for
and
sure,
honestly, man,
you need,
like,
those people in your life.
You know what, really, after that, like, you know, I had mad love for him, but after that it was even you know, it excelled a lot more. You know, not a lot of people are going to tell you, hey, like, you're having too much fun, you know, because everybody wants you to have fun. But, you know, he's been there, done that, man. You know, he's lived that life, you know, fought some of the dopest fighters from BJ Penn. Oh, Nate Diaz, too. He's going to be
I
fighting.
I can imagine all the world champions that he's, you know what I mean?
Yeah, man. He told me a story once where he was in Vegas, and so he was a lightweight. He was in Vegas, and I don't remember who he told me he was fighting, but anyways, or maybe he was done with the fight, and, you know, he's at the hotel, like a bar in a hotel, and BJ Penn was on the same card, same weight division and stuff, and BJ Penn walks up to him and starts chopping it up with him and says, hey, we're going to fight. And Joe was just like, what do you mean we're going to fight, you know? And BJ Penn was like, yeah, man, you're dope. You know, your game's dope. And BJ was the champion at that time. And Joe ended up, you know, in the future fighting him.
That was a great fucking fight. I remember that shit. I was so excited. I was like, Joe, he got his shot. Like, he's getting his shot. Like, it was dope.
Yeah, man. Yeah, that's crazy.
And it really resonates with that guy and, like, a lot of, I think, his fans, because he wasn't, like, he wasn't that big John Jones guy that fuck guys up. He looked like me and you.
Yeah, man.
You know what I mean? And you could tell his work ethic, and he just set himself apart from all the other guys, like, on Ultimate Fighter, and then he went into the UFC and he started dominating.
Yeah. He was training for a long-ass time. I think my coach said he started training with them when he was about 10 years old. So this was probably like the early 2000s, maybe the 1990 and stuff, dude. Like, Joe's,
I don't know if this is a fake dope story, but I heard, like, he lied about his age, and he, like, because I remember seeing him on King of the Cage, and I heard that he used to fight when he was like 16 or some shit like that. Like,
oh, I'm pretty sure he did.
I heard
I'm
he fought
sure
when he was really, really young, you know what I mean? Allegedly,
sure,
guys, allegedly.
Yeah, I'm pretty
but
sure.
But the guy's
he
a
did
fucking legend.
Yeah, man.
I remember watching his highlights from King of the Cage, and it was like, whoa, that guy.
Dude, he's dope, man. I have a lot of respect for him, man. Really dope. Dope dude, man. Good. He's fucking phenomenal at what he does. His jiu-jitsu's good, and a ton of knowledge, man.
So that's cool. Knowledge. He has California Fight League. How many, like amateur, pro, like, you know what I mean? Like, before you get into, like, because everybody knows about the Bellators, the UFCs, you know what I mean? But is there, like, a lot in California? Is it, like, something that is, like, are we more special than the rest of the United States? Or, like, how is the opportunities out here versus, you know?
You know what, as far as promotions go?
Yeah, I know, because they got, like,
you know what,
King
dude,
of the
there's
Cage,
a ton out
Gladiator
here, man. There's a ton of promotions out here. I mean, it's California, you know, everything's here. There's a ton, dude, like, you could, if you want to watch MMA, live MMA, you could go to a show every weekend between pros and amateurs. There's always amateur shows. Always amateur shows. So we have a guy fighting Sunday. And this just happened fucking, I think, yesterday or today. We found out he was fighting. So, yeah, we have a guy fighting Sunday. There's a show Saturday in Long Beach. There's they're all over, man. They're all over. So, you know, we're fortunate enough to where you want to get that experience, you can, as an amateur, or if you need to rack up some wins or get some more experience as a pro, too. You could do it out here just on the West Coast, you know? Yeah.
So, like, talk about wins and losses. MMA, it's not like boxing. Like, Mayweather is like, people are undefeated, and now boxing is like, oh, you got to be undefeated or else you're fucking whatever. But MMA is completely different.
Yeah.
You see a lot of losses on people's records. And I kind of feel like, because it's like, you have to know everything. Or, you know, if you don't know anything these days, they'll just expose you. And now, you know what I
there's
mean?
There's so much to cover, man. There's so much to cover. So, you know how they say styles make fights in boxing, right? Because it does. Think about MMA, right? Now you got a style for stand-up. Style,
yeah, they talk
for
about
the transitions,
like,
or the styles for the fucking on the ground, you know? You're grappling skill set, so you know that all plays into fights. You know, you could get a Jake Shields and a Damian Maia fighting, and they're both fucking phenomenal on the ground.
So they might just stand up.
Yeah, and so it might be, and you've seen it. It might be just a boring ass fight because these two dudes are so dope at what they do that neither of them are gonna fucking be able to, you know, get
and
a finish.
Sometimes you see, like, it cancels their styles, cancel themselves out, so they're just like, okay, well, we're just gonna do this other thing. Like, I think I forgot who it was, but I think it was maybe Rashad Evans and John Jones, like everyone thought they were gonna fight, and then they ended up going on the ground for like a few rounds, and it was like,
it was a little boring, huh?
And it was like, yeah. Whoa, what are these guys doing? But it was like, oh, okay, like they're kind of the same. So
yeah, I don't really remember that one too well.
Yeah, it was a long time ago. Shout out to Rashad. He just retired. And, I mean, I don't know if he retired, but he just got inducted into the Hall of Fame.
I think he did retire after.
I used to hate that guy.
Week. Really? Why?
Well, I didn't hate him so much, but I was such a big Machida fan, and I went to the fight at the MGM Grand. Fucking Machida versus Rashad, and when he knocked out Rashad, fucking silly.
Oh, you loved it?
Such a big Machida fan, bro, that I was so happy.
Who else did Rashad get knocked out by?
Oh, he got knocked out a few times, pretty brutal.
Really?
Because I remember when he was in the Ultimate Fighter, he was a wrestler. And he did so well, and then he knocked out fucking Chuck with this crazy-ass right hand from hell.
I think he knocked him out, and Chuck was out for about 4 minutes.
Dude, that was one of the still is one of the craziest knockouts. Crazy. If you guys know what we're talking about, go look at Rashad Chuck Liddell knockout. God damn, that shit.
Yeah,
heard around the world.
Didn't he took the title from him, right? That's who took
that
the title.
After that knockout, I'm pretty sure that's why, like, I don't think he was, like, Chuck's chin was the same after that.
Yeah.
Like, people talk about, like,
but he had
chin
mileage on him.
Exactly.
He had mileage on him.
Exactly. Memory. Mileage.
Yeah. Same thing. It does have a memory. Oh, man. Yeah, Chuck had mileage on him. You know what was a dope Chuck fight, though? Was him and Rich Franklin.
Oh, yeah. Rich Franklin. A lot of people don't know about Rich Franklin, but that motherfucker had a lot of good fights.
Yeah, Jim Carrey looking motherfucker.
Fucking teacher by day, fighter by night.
Yeah. How fucking confusing is that, right? Like, imagine if you were a student. That's probably what we need nowadays. You see these kids fucking back-talking kids. Like, yo, let's get all these teachers fucking trained, bro. Get them all trained. You know, I bet none of the kids are fucking giving Mr. Franklin.
See, I think that's what's fucked up with schools, man. You know what's cool is I see, like, some new kind of schools. Like, they're not all, like, church schools, but, like, some private schools. They'll be meditating for like 20 minutes to start the day and shit like that. But me, it's like PE, nerd PE. That's what I played football and baseball in high school, so we called the regular kids nerd PE. But it's like, dude, growing up, like, why wouldn't you hire like a karate coach, taekwondo coach, or like, oh, they do have wrestling,
yeah,
but like, why can't that be an option instead of just doing regular PE? Why can't we, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Let's do a little something else, especially like we're in the future.
Kickball or some shit.
Right? Let's teach a kid how to defend themselves.
Yeah, I don't know what country it is, but I know, like, I think Sambo is a requirement for PE.
Oh, wow, that's fucking great.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I think Sambo. Fuck. Imagine, probably Armenia or something. Like, I don't know. Don't
imagine being in fifth grade and just finding out about your penis and you're doing some Sambo with some girl that's barely growing her tits. I'm sorry, guys. I'm not trying to throw out some super young stuff out
there.
But, sorry, man. Sorry. I was just thinking the first worst thing that could happen.
Right? Boner? Oh, you're grappling? Oh, man.
Dude, I was at just real quick to talk. We're getting a little messy real quick.
It's messy. It's just time,
talk about,
bro.
Talk about a boner. It's about time. What is it? 1 a.m. or an hour into my birthday?
Bro, it's the messy hour.
Yep. These late night messy episodes.
And
getting
it's
crazy.
Time to get messy with Messy Crib at the Messy Crib in the late hours of the night.
So I took my roommate the other day. I was like, hey, let's go get a massage. She was like, $20? What? Let's do it. And I was like, yeah, they're just going to be Asian. $20, you know what I'm saying? So it was all good, though. And so I'm not trying to be racist, guys, but it's true. So we went to this massage place right here in Riverside, and it was fucking awesome. Full-blown body massage, but you know how they, like, do the little chopping things on your fucking back?
Karate chops.
Yeah, little karate chops. Yeah. Like, it feels great. But I don't remember her ever doing it like when I'm on my back and she's doing it like on my stomach and then she's going to my thighs. Well, while she was doing it, bro, she fucking hit the tip of my dick.
What?
Bro,
did you punch her?
No. She just hit the tip of my dick, so it was like a tingling
she
sensation.
Did it on purpose.
Bro, the first thing that went to my head was like, don't get a boner. JR. Like, dude, come on, think about it, bro.
Yeah.
And I'm not gonna lie, she was like 40, but she looked like she was 28. Some Asian lady, and she was really strong, and it was kind of like, it was like, Like, you don't want to think about them, but that's every, like, fucking 13-year-old's fucking, like, their fantasy their and fantasy. Shit. To go fuck a fucking masseuse. Oh, but anyway, man. So she hit my dick, bro, and right away, like, you don't think like, about it. It makes you think about it more. Yeah, I started thinking about baseball. I was like, Yankees, what's the starting lineup today? And it just wasn't fucking working
then
today.
Then everything turns into fucking dicks. Start thinking of baseball bats. Fucking like, wood. Like, come on, bro. Associates.
Dude, it was all bad. And then, like, two seconds later when I noticed my shit started growing, because I'm a grower.
Yeah.
Just let all the ladies out there, just to let you guys know, I'm a grower.
Yeah.
You know, when I'm sitting down, sometimes it could be a little turtled up, but I'm definitely a grower. A little better than average. Especially since I lost weight, I gained like an inch.
All right.
But anyways, so I was at the massage parlor, and right after that shit started happening, bro. Like, less than 10 seconds. I don't know if she started seeing something, but she told me to turn around on my stomach, so... I really don't know. It's been haunting my nightmares. The past
okay, turn
days.
Around.
Okay, sir, turn around. Sir, turn around. Not fast enough.
Damn, bro. Then you had to fucking suffocate that fool.
Yeah, so I felt like a fucking like a 12-year-old all over again.
Yeah, bro. Since we're talking about dicks,
you knew two dudes in a conversation
right,
together.
Right, right.
Dicks are
what's
bound to be talked about.
What's the funniest thing you've ever heard a dick called?
Whatever,
or one of your favorite
called?
To go. Yeah, one of your favorite to go to's.
Ooh. So you tell me your story first.
Bro,
I've
heard
a little
fucking
bit.
One Eye Cyclops. Sour Cream Rifle.
Damn, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I just keep thinking about Mandingo. I don't know why. I think that's like a famous porn star's. Like, I think that's the name of his
really?
Dick. I don't know. But it just
his
reminds me of a black dude's
Mandingo?
Huge dick. Maybe
God
is that
damn.
Just a saying? Like, oh, you got a Mandingo. Just. I have no clue why Mandingo goes into my head. You're the one that asked me about the dick joke, bro. Now I can't get Mandingo out of
got
my head.
Mandingo and all the messy listeners out there. All
right, so speaking of things that are shaped like dicks, bro, let's talk about some party times. I see that banana on your hat. Does that resemble
shit.
Like something?
Yeah, bro. Fucking. Oh man, where do I even start?
What do you guys call yourselves, or what is it? Is it like
know, man,
a crew? Like,
yeah. So I have some friends that started. It's actually just really them. They include us. They include us. They're called the Banana Movement. So how this came about was there's this EDM duo called Dada Life, Ole and Stefan. They're really high energy music. It's not mainstream EDM. It's not dubstep. It's what we call happy face music, because it's just high energy. You get out on the dance floor, you're doing your thing, and like everybody's smiling, bro. Everybody's smiling, just having a good time. So anyways, their theme's champagne and bananas. So a lot of people are like, what the fuck, champagne and bananas? So Dada Life's whole thing is you know, they keep it classy, champagne or bananas, just average, whatever, you know. So that's their theme, champagne and bananas. It's pretty dope. The whole Dada Life experience is amazing. I'll get into that. But anyway, so a bunch of, you know, we actually call ourselves Banana Fam. Is what we call ourselves, Banana Fam. It's just a bunch of random people who, honestly, the majority of us have met randomly being at shows, just... Oh damn, what's up? You're wearing a banana. That's so cool. Like, where do I get mine? Where did you get yours? Or how can I get one? How can I hang out with you guys again? Or like, let's link up at a different party if you're local. And then you know, that's how it's just grown, man. Like, it was pretty big before I started hanging out with them, and it's only grown you know. So
that's cool
more.
That's cool that you guys call it Banana Fam, because I've only been to one rave and I got two more planned up to come at the end of this year. But like, that's how you feel. You feel you're so connected to everybody, and you do feel like a family. Like, anybody that's alone, like, oh, yeah, come join us. No problem.
Yeah, yeah. Well, man, you know what? That's one of the things that just goes on with that kind of scene. You know, everybody's just so open and ready.
It's
to,
funny,
because
if you're not in that scene,
on.
People
it
don't
looks,
fucking
it,
know.
It looks weird.
Yeah,
looks weird. You know, like,
weird.
Why are you walking around wearing fucking... anal, not anal beads, but beads.
You know, I've probably seen some
anal
beads.
You put your little bracelets away now. EDC's over. You see all the fucking little ravers walking around with bracelets 3 months later and their little wristbands from the event. But, you know, dude, it's cool, man. Like, it gives people, a lot of people, something to look forward to. And a lot of people use it for an escape. You know, I just could have a good time, bro. You know, it's a lot of fun. It's a ton of fun. Yeah, man. So, yeah. Anyways, the boys I chill with, the crew, they're called a Banana Movement. And it's just really about expressing yourself, you know. And they're good at it. It's fucking great ass community though, man. It's such a great, well, my fam. And you know what's dope though, is a lot of people say, oh yeah, this is like my rave fam, that's what they call them. Man, a lot of my friends, like, dude, some of these dudes are my best friends now, you know. And it's pretty crazy to think about it, like, dude, I've only been hanging out with them for like 3 years, you know. And then the next thing you know, you find you've got a lot of the same common interests. Showing up to the same places because you're having fun, and it's just a fucking good time, man. It's a fucking good time. Yeah, so, but that all came about because of Dot of Life, man. All came about because of Dot of Life.
That's fucking dope.
Yeah, man, a lot of fun. But yeah, man, this year, I think I'll probably do like 2 or 3 more shows that I have planned. I think Hard Summer, what else do I have planned? Hard Summer is a big one. Nocturnal, and then Escape's this big ass Halloween one. Just check it out.
Oh yeah, Halloween time.
Yeah, man, it's pretty dope.
Oh, that's
and
sick.
You know what?
And I always try to find something to do during Halloween too.
Bro, go listen to good music, hang out with people,
cool,
dance your ass
kid, right?
off. Like, goddamn, it's dope. People dress up like the craziest fucking costumes you're gonna see is there. It's dope, man. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I got to switch it up. Normally, I'm like a baseball player every year. It's just like a backup. So I'm just going to be a baseball player.
Yankees.
Yeah, yep, man. Yankees away. I got gray pants and a gray jersey.
There you go, man.
But yeah, I got to definitely, I might have to be like Macho Man out there or something.
There you go. One thing that's pretty trendy is whatever's trendy at the time. You know, everybody fucking kind of shows up like that. So. Excuse me. Yeah, so, but they're a ton of fun, man. Get out to those things. And you know what's crazy is because people travel around the world to fucking show up to these events and party their ass off.
Yeah, it's crazy. I'll see people like they're in, like, you just got done seeing a bunch of people that just got back from EDC, and that's like, is that a week long event?
The EDC show event is actually 3 days.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but you could head up there a day before to camp, start camping. And then in Vegas, they call it like EDC week, so they have parties before and parties after EDC.
So give me a little breakdown, bro. We're going to Nocturnal, and we got camping passes next to our car.
Oh, dope. Dope. So that means you'll probably set a tent up next to – I've never camped at Nocturnal, but – I think I'm going to do it this year because it's the last year at that venue, and that venue is, it's magnificent.
It's, yeah, I'm dope, fucking, bro, excited, man. I'm stoked.
Yeah, one thing that I know a lot of people were, like, a little upset about was the hours. The hours, because out here in California, we could party till 2 o'clock, right? But they're ending it at 12.
Oh, shit. What is it normally at 2?
So, yeah, it's about 2 o'clock, so 1:45, 2 o'clock.
So what time does it start?
It depends. This probably start around 5 or 6 o'clock.
Oh, I thought they were from like 12 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon till fucking...
It, like I said, it could depend. It just depends on what the they have set up. But so what I heard, though, is a lot of people were kind of like complaining about it ending early. But if you're camping, that's going to be dope for you, because then you go back to the camp with all the people you're camping with. And then they have silent disco. I don't know if you've ever
heard
of those.
So much about
that.
I've been wanting to go. Explain to what the people that don't know what it is.
So silent disco is you go to a party, and when you get into the party, they're handing you headphones. So they don't have a regular PA. You have a headset with channels on it, and you could switch back and forth between DJs. Sometimes they have 2-3 DJs. I'm pretty sure they, you know. Maybe just one. The first disco I went to was kind of whatever. I didn't care for it, but I went to this one up in Washington at this show, Paradiso, last year, which was fucking amazing. Have you ever heard of the Gorge?
Yeah.
Dude, fucking dope ass venue. Their main stage is set up, and the back are behind it. They have a fucking a canyon with a fucking river in it.
Like, damn, that's
so you're
massive.
Watching music and you're just out there in nature, bro. It's dope as fuck. Anyways,
how many stages are normally at like these festivals?
Dude, it just depends. Like, Insomniac.
I've only been to like a reggae festival and like just regular
yeah,
concerts.
You might get like two or three really big ones and then a bunch of small ones. But the big ones, man, now they're fucking crazy, bro. LED screens all over, all
dude,
different
they're
shapes
like, they
and
look
sizes.
Like goddamn Disneyland. It looks like a mini circus on stage.
Fuck, yeah, man. It's crazy, right? It's crazy. That shit is just blows my mind. The first one I went to, they had fucking big-ass props. Like, now they don't really have props on the stage. It's just screens with all the fucking visuals. But they had fucking trees and owls, big-ass trees, big-ass owls. And this is crazy, man. It's a fucking,
man, that's fucking massive. I can't fucking wait. If you do go to Nocturnal, let me know, man. We got a link.
Oh,
up.
Definitely, dude. Definitely. I know a few of my friends are going to end up camping. It's right down the street from me, but I'm going to camp anyways because it's going to be the last one there for a little while. So, you know what fucking gets me, that fucking gets me pissed?
What gets you, oh, I was going to say, what gets your dick hard, buddy?
No, what gets
you angry, bro? What triggers you?
Fucking the community that fucking built houses around that venue. This venue has been there. I fucking, the Beatles probably played there,
yeah,
right? Like, this place
while.
Is historic, right? So then this
talking about Glen Helen.
Yeah,
everybody.
So the motherfucking communities decided, like, fucking build homes around there. And these motherfuckers are giving, like, noise complaints and shit like that. Like, come on.
That's
what the fuck? Like,
terrible.
You're gonna fucking move next to a fucking venue like that?
Dude, they had Ozfest there for so many fucking years.
Yeah, man. And I think traffic might fucking get them a little mad too. But you know what, dude? These shows bring in so many people. Like, it's good for the local economy.
Yeah,
it's
for sure.
It's fucking great for the local economy. You know, like, they're bringing in definitely over 100,000 people over the weekend that are from out of town. Like, come on, bro, they're spending money. Like, you know,
you can imagine how much better it is, you know, for the local. Like, that's why I love like Citizens Bank Arena. Like, that's dope.
They just changed the name for that place Toyota is something.
Some fucking white fucking corporate motherfucker.
Right.
No, it's cool. It's a platform for everybody to, you know.
Yeah.
It's like a mini staple center. I really like that place.
Yeah, dude. So, but yeah, dude, camping should be real good time there, man. Real good time there. Fucking, it's in September, so like, fucking, it gets warm in the mornings though. So fucking, if you're camping in a tent instead of an RV, I don't know, man. You might be fucking assed out. Try to get under a tree and put your tent under there, because once that sun comes up, it gets hot.
Oh yeah, I was like, I definitely got to bring a canopy or some kind of easy up. Man.
But dude, they do all kinds of cool shit during the day there. They have water slides there too.
What? So,
yeah, because it's right there at the fucking the Glen Helen Park.
I've only been fishing there.
They have water slides and you go swimming. They set up pools and stuff like that. So
oh,
really
that's
dope,
sick
dude.
As fuck.
Yeah, man. They have all these.
Damn, I gotta hit the gym with you, bro.
They have all these dope ass activities, fucking goat yoga and shit. If you're into yoga,
what? I'm about to fucking have a goat touch my nuts when I'm doing yoga.
Yeah, man. Fuck yeah. So that's pretty dope, man. Good shit.
That's good dope, shit. Man. I can't fucking wait to go to Nocturnal. I'm supposed to go to some other show in Vegas too, but we'll see how that goes. I don't really know what that is. That might be like a hip hop show.
Really? Yeah, you know what, I don't think I've been to a hip hop show ever.
You know, that's what
been
I was
to,
telling
like
my
rock
friend.
Concerts and
that's what I was
raves.
Telling my friend. I was like, I've seen Green Day, I've seen a lot of fucking rock shows, I've been to a lot of country concerts, but I've been to like one underground hip hop show, but it wasn't really like a real hip hop show.
Dude, you know, I fucking just went to. You ever heard of the Upland Lemon Festival?
Oh hell yeah! Like on Thursdays or something like that.
No, it comes around like once a year. And it's like a weekend event.
Oh,
there.
Okay.
Dude, so I seen this tribute band called Queen Nation.
What?
Fucking nailed it, bro. Straight up nailed it. Everything from the lead singer being like Freddie Mercury.
Like a fag. Just what?
I don't know, bro.
possibly.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say no.
Well, they dressed up. The dude was like super flamboyant on stage too. Like he really embodied Freddie Mercury's
that's fucking
part.
Beautiful. That's awesome.
Not only did he do that for the performance, like his dancing and like his whole charisma on stage and stuff like that. Like, he totally looked the part. Obviously, not really looking like Freddie Mercury, but looked the part as far as dancing and all that stuff. Sang, just the vocals were on point. It sounded just like him. The dude plays, so the lead singer also plays the piano. And it was pretty dope, dude. Very talented band, but that was probably one of my favorite fucking most recent things I've done as far as music.
That's dope too.
Yeah, dude, fucking cover band, man.
And that's really intimate. Like, there's not that many people, you know. Like, there's a lot of people at the festival, but it's like,
dude, you know what? There was a lot of fucking people, bro. There was probably like a good, I would have to say, between 2,000 and 2,500 people at that stage.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, man. You know what's funny, though? It was a change for me was partying with older people, like middle-aged people.
Oh, yeah. Only fucking old people go to Lemon Festivals.
All right, bro. Dude.
They take their kids. People that have kids go to Lemon Festivals.
So one of the fucking funny things was
hey, did you take some chick that had her kid, or how'd you go?
Oh, no. Nah, man.
I know you're a pimp, bro. You ain't got a lot. I know you get the bitches, dog.
Nah, man. I went with my cousin.
She's a nice lady. You're married a whore. I'm just playing. That's cool, though.
Yeah, so anyways, with my cousin and friend, because they live right up the street from where it was, and just walked down. We were actually going to grab lunch, and they were like, oh, it's Lemon Festival. And I seen, or had saw fucking on one of the stages, I was looking at the performers, and then I seen Queen Nation, Queen Tribute Band. I was like, what? I want to come check these fools out. And I thought there'd probably be like 20, 30 people there. Nah, fucking, these people have a following. Fucking pretty dope shit. So yeah, man, that shit was pretty fun, dude. But oh, funny story was, like, I kind of get irritated when I'm in crowds and people just keep bumping, or, you know, you're watching a fucking show and someone tall comes up in front of you and just starts blocking your fucking, your view and shit. Anyways, so there's a lot of people just sitting down at the show, and there's this older white lady and like her friends. They're standing up because they're getting it to the music, and they were kind of like bothering people behind them. But it was funny because one of the older ladies, she had her arms up and just straight bat flaps, bro, like flapping everywhere, bro,
oh,
just straight like waving
her
hands in the air. And she didn't care, bro. But those bat flaps were just like going everywhere, man. That shit.
Nobody
was
told her
funny.
Anything.
Nah, bro.
Fuck. Was she white?
Yeah, bigger white lady.
Yeah. Sometimes you just don't tell white people shit. It's like, oh well, they're allowed to do it.
Yeah. She's just living her best.
Unless
life.
There's a black person like two rows back, then they might say something.
Yeah, man.
Hey, bitch. I'm just playing.
Yeah, dude. You know what? You know, they're bringing Woodstock back around.
What?
Yeah, man. It's this year, and I think it's actually, like, pretty close to maybe happening. Like, the date, as far as that goes.
What the
yeah,
fuck?
They're bringing
that
shit. That. No.
That's, like, my number one complaint. I always come, like, people that I know
dude,
that love
no,
rock
no,
and roll.
It's back this year, bro. It's back this fucking year. So, I'm curious, though. Like, I want to go. I want to see the line. That's what I want to see. Like, I want to see who's headlining. I want to see all that stuff. But, like, I fucking want to go to that shit. Like, who don't want to go to fucking Woodstock?
Damn, that's massive. Where was Woodstock at? Where was something?
Wasn't it like Michigan or something?
I remember it being
Michigan,
somewhere
right?
Super fucking far.
Yeah. I think like Michigan.
All I really remember from Woodstock, of course I remember the shows and the concerts, but I just remember a bunch of hippies walking through grasslands to go to the fucking.
Dude, so I heard a funny story about Carlos Santana up in Woodstock. Was I guess, and you can find this on YouTube too. Someone gave him some acid before he was going up to play.
What?
Yeah, man. And he was just tripping balls, bro. Tripping balls. He said that he was fucking just playing. That the fucking like the neck of the guitar was like a snake. And just like moving around, and he just said he started like making love to it or some shit like that, man. But it's pretty funny. So I was listening to that story, and whoever was supposed to play at that time slot couldn't play, and then they had fucking Carlos and his squad got that spot, and they weren't even known at the time, and it was a very big hour. Like, it was one of those like hours that you want to play, and that's how he really got a lot of exposure that way.
Damn, that's crazy.
Band, no, you, yeah. I didn't, and he I was didn't, fucked up. and he fucking just blew their minds.
You know what's crazy is that I when you mentioned Carlson, I was like, oh, of course he would be there at Woodstock. But then I'm like, oh, shit, Carlos Santana is at Woodstock. And then you're like, oh, yeah, of course he wouldn't have been well-known back then.
Yeah.
Like, dude, that's fucking crazy. Amazing,
bro. How bad is he, though?
Yeah, dude.
And coming from nowhere. Crazy story, too, man. Did you ever hear about him, like, finding his old drummer on the streets?
What?
No. Yeah, dude. So, fucking his drummer was like a hippie and a bum. And I don't know how they found him. But anyways, Carlos, like, scooped him up and changed his life again. So, yeah, man.
Damn, that's fucking massive, man. Yeah. Fucking. Those are, like, when you see, like, Jimi Hendrix, Carlos Santana. I just watched a fucking documentary on Netflix about some fucking black jazz player. I forgot what his fucking name was, but he made like a deal with the devils. Fucking like a simple, like it was like supposedly
a guitar,
like,
player. Yeah?
Yeah. And he like supposedly made the deal with the devil, some crossroads or whatever, but he was just like the sickest player ever. And it just tells a story, and it's fucking nuts that, like, that's one of the reasons why we started this podcast. It's a messy crib. Everyone comes from fucking messy fucking places. I don't care who you are.
Yeah.
And you see these talented people, and it's like, he went on acid and he played this killer set fucking Woodstock when right. He wasn't even well known. Of course he was. He's a fucking legend. Like, these guys, they don't make him the same.
Yeah, man. Yeah, fucking. This is crazy.
That's trip,
man.
Though. Fucking Woodstock. I might have to add that to the list.
Yeah, man.
I'm gonna look that up.
Yeah, I think it's fucking like the date should be fucking like really soon. Let me check this out. Woodstock. So, fuck.
That's fucking massive.
Woodstock Festival.
I seen, my favorite probably rock concert was when I seen Green Day. I went to go see Blink-182, and they were just pretty much dog shit. I mean, other than Travis Barker spinning in circles on a sick-ass drum set, Blink-182 is pretty much dog shit.
Yeah.
But Green Day took fucking over.
Oh, August fucking 16th and 18th.
Oh, shit. That's fucking massive.
What? At an undetermined location, the event will be of the 50th anniversary.
So everybody, this is going to be released pretty soon in the next, in the future. So you'll be able to go to Woodstock, and maybe we'll see you guys there. Woodstock is back.
So
yeah!
The lineup, though, is kind of weird. Not weird, but...
Who's headlining?
I don't say, but Woodstock lineup, Jay-Z.
Oh, shit. What the
Why?
Fuck?
All right. The Killers. That's cool.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine Dragons.
Yeah.
Halsey.
All right, bro. We'll talk about this another day.
Yeah, man.
We'll talk about this another day. All I had to hear was
depressing.
Imagine Dragons. You know what's funny is when people say some weird shit, I'm like, Imagine Dragons? It's like my number one joke.
Funny, bro. Imagine.
Did you watch Game of Thrones?
Yeah, I did watch it.
Oh, okay.
Dude,
did you like that?
I didn't get into it till season 6.
That's cool.
Did I like what? Oh, the ending? You know what? I don't think anybody would have been happy with it either way.
That's exactly what I'm like.
I don't think people would have been happy. It could have been a fucking, like, everybody died and only Jon Snow lived.
Oh, you were happy every season till the ending, right? That's like, shut the fuck up.
I don't know. A lot of people were like, oh, it's predictable. Like, you figured, you know, that was going to happen. You know, John fucking doing what he did. Won't give away anything.
I was tripping out because when I watched the whatever they released after it ended, and when they were reading the script and they were all crying,
and they were all like,
I was like, whoa, this is pretty cool. Like, this is dope. Like, this is that. They gave me a whole nother. That made me appreciate the last episode a lot more.
Yeah.
Like, they didn't really know, like, this is kind of what they're told.
Yeah.
You know
and
what I'm
you
saying?
See the actor crying and
like Jon Snow
like,
is like, oh, I got to kill you, Daenerys. Fuck. He's like,
yeah.
Can I touch your tit as I'm fucking stabbing you?
Yeah. How fine is she, though?
I know, right?
Emilia Clarke? Is that her name?
I don't know. But she's like, if she was an MMA fighter, it would be pretty close to Paige VanZant.
Oh, yo. Do you follow Paige on that?
Hell yeah.
Oh,
dude, have you watched her food truck diary?
No.
It just came out. Brendan Schaub, her food truck diary, bro. All I'm going to say, folks, is go check it out because her top, it's like Jennifer Aniston in every episode of Friends. Her fucking nipples are, you can just see them. And she looks like she's about to play tennis. Like, her top, like, it's one of those cuts that you can almost see her bottom tit, like low tit.
Yeah.
But you can't quite see it, though. And she's like, oh, my husband's over there, and he's the one that picked it out. It's like, okay. But anyways, fucking Paige Van Zandt's a man. Daenerys, I don't know. If I had both of them in the room and I had to choose one, I might just kill myself.
I don't think I'd kill myself, bro.
Well, I don't know. I would be like, because, you know, I'd bust a nut in like a minute and a half, and I'd be like, fuck, I should have fucked the other one. I might have lasted a little longer.
Oh, man. That's funny. You ever hear, like, fucking to jack off before you go fucking, you last longer?
Yeah.
Yeah, that shit don't work for me, bro. Like, if I'm going to go early, I'm just going to go early, man. Sorry. You know?
Yeah. I mean, it's hard to say because if I'm really into the chick, then the second time really won't help that much. But if I do bust two quick nuts, the third time I'll usually do better. But if I'm not really into the chick and I bust the first nut, usually the second time I go a lot harder.
Yeah.
But I need a pregame for sure. I can't please women. I gotta get them halfway there first before I even decide to stick this little J-Rod in there.
So you got to do, bro, is downplay it all the time. Just downplay it. Yeah. You know, so this way they're figuring like, oh, I'm just going to be nice. I'm going to be nice. Like, whatever. He's a nice guy. And then if you're average, like, you downplayed it, then they're going to be happy as fuck.
Like, I'm only like, you know, 5 inches. Oh, dude, you're like five and a half, 6 inches.
Yeah, like, hey.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that. Oh, okay. Must have got a little bigger. You know, I saw you know what I mean? It grew a little.
Yeah.
I remember my baseball coach used to be like, you got a cup on, right? He'd be like, yeah. He's like, I don't want that shit starting to grow. And he'd be like, you know, if you rub it enough, it'll start growing. It's kind of weird.
It's like magic.
A 14-year-old. I remember my coach would walk around with the fucking fungo, and he would check your fucking cup if you're wearing a cup, and he would just walk by.
What's a fungo?
It's a really skinny metal bat to hit like ground balls and pop flies.
Oh, okay.
It's not like a regular bat.
Yeah.
And so he would walk around with the fungo, and he would just fucking just swing that shit real quick and hit you in the nuts, check see if you're wearing a cup.
Yeah, that's fucked up, bro.
Yeah, it's all bad.
I'm not gonna lie, bro. So with training, bro, I don't fucking wear a cup.
No, I would think you guys would wear like a soft cup.
No, I don't like wearing a cup. So the reason being is because you know, when you're grappling or even kickboxing. So when you're grappling,
yeah, dude,
like
some guys get kicked and kneed in the nuts pretty fucking hard.
Well, here's the thing though, is like you don't have to take a direct hit with the cup on, right? So say like kind of catches high up into like your pelvic area and the cup is up there, right? So if that gets hit and it just fucking smashes your balls and your dick, like that don't feel good. That's like getting hit. So the actual direct shots compared to like the indirect shots,
I would say like a less likely to actually hit in the nuts.
Yeah. At least for me, bro, my experience, I don't know about anybody else's, but for myself, man, like I don't like grappling with cups on. I don't like fucking kickboxing or sparring with cups on. Like I don't like it. Cause you know, you get hit fucking right under your belly button and you're getting fucking, you're fucking dying.
Yeah, I never wore a cup until my senior year. They made us wear cups on varsity, and but I just felt like I couldn't move. I felt like it was like something there. Like I never got hit in the nuts ever. Yeah,
it's annoying.
But yeah, it's like,
annoying. Yeah, you have to wear them when you fight though.
Yeah.
So I have to fucking wear a cup when I fight. That shit. Fucking. I don't know, man.
Have you ever gotten hit in the nuts hard?
Hell yeah. Oh, yeah, I've been hit in the nuts.
So this is our segment where we talk about when Jay got hit in the nuts.
Yo, okay, so real story. So it's probably like 2008. I'm going on a Friday night to the gym to spar, and I'm sparring with this dude. His name's Kevin. Kevin's probably like 40 at the time. I think I'm like 20, 21. Kevin's been using steroids his whole life.
Kevin has small nuts.
Kevin's been fucking, his arms are bigger than my torso, right? Anyways, we're sparring, and he wasn't the most athletic guy, but he's big powerhouse. Anyways, he goes throw push kick's the front kick, you know, bring your knee up, put your foot in their belly, push them
for you fucking retards, or I'm not gonna say that's politically correct, I'm sorry, you fucktards out there. That's when like a cop kicks a door down.
That would be
equivalent of a push kick, right?
Yeah. So anyways, Kevin's like 6'4", something. He's big.
He's kicking your ass a few feet back.
Yeah. And he's probably kicking like my face with the push kick anyways. I'm short. Well, this dude has no flexibility and hits me in the nuts. Yo, it was bad. Like,
bro, did your nuts go around your like body back into your butthole?
Yeah, bro, they got shoved up into like my stomach, everything, bro. Like, it was bad. Anyway, so I was like, fuck, as soon as I got hit, and he launched me too. I fucking hit the fucking canvas, right? And I'm like, just like, oh shit, like, damn, fucking the worst fucking I've ever been kicked in the balls. Actually, another time. Fucking I'm over there like, damn, like, oh, this hurts. And I open my eyes and I see everybody fucking around Kevin, and Kevin's on the floor too. And I'm like, what the fuck happened to this fool? And anyways, I'm over here like, why are they over there around him, not me? Anyways, he's all on the floor holding his foot. He broke his two toes, bro.
Damn, my shit junk. Got caught in your nuts. Yeah, damn, homie. Damn, ladies. Shit. That's how big fucking Jay's dick is. That fool broke that fool's fucking toes.
Fucking real story, bro. Seen the x-rays and everything. I did. So I used to do these amateur fights called smokers back in the day for kickboxing, because there was no amateur shows for, fighting. So I was doing this amateur kickboxing show, and I got kicked twice with the dude tried to go for inside leg kick, and I couldn't even continue the match, and I was just puking. Got kicked twice in the balls. That shit sucks.
You see it, and it's like, oh, you get 5 minutes,
and it hurts you.
Dude,
like,
you get a
stomachache. Yeah,
and it's like, oh, they get 5 minutes, and it's weird when you see these guys. Oh, I'm good to go. But I'm like, I can imagine the adrenaline they're going through, but. Man, bro, I trip out. Oh, the other day I was watching, I think it was Bellator. I think it was the first time I ever seen a girl get kicked in the fucking vagina.
Did she go down?
Yeah, she went down and she was fucking squinting. No, it was in the UFC. And she was squinting in pain. She was hurting, bro.
Damn.
It was crazy. And she got up like after like 3 minutes. She was like, all right, I'm ready to go again. But yeah, that was crazy. I was tripping out. I was like, damn, that clit got popped.
Oh, bad, man. Have you ever seen a fighter shit themselves? Did you see that UFC fight where homegirl shit herself?
No, I didn't, but I saw clips about it, but I didn't see the fight.
Oh, that's pretty good.
I seen highlights, some other dude that shit himself too, some black dude, but that's a Google thing I Googled one time, but yeah. No, I've never seen anybody
I've never went out of my way to look it up, but I remember...
Bro, if I hear somebody shits themselves, I'm probably going to look it up.
No, I forget what I was watching, but I remember Forrest Griffin, though. That's why he ran out of the cage when he fucking fought Anderson Silva.
No way.
It was
because
he said he had to shit himself, yeah, while he was about to shit himself. Like, you fucking...
He had brown shorts. He probably shit himself and just ran out.
All right. Oh, man. You hear that Deadpool line? Remember, like, this guy should have wear his brown pants. Oh, yeah, man. That shit's funny, dude. Yeah.
You know, I fucking love you, Jay, and it's been awesome talking MMA, but that's not who you are, man. I want to talk to some other stuff. We talked a little bit about your partying days, and you like to have a good time, but one of the reasons I think you're one of the most fucking just... awesome people, and you're so dynamic as an individual, because I think it's like kind of where you came from. And if you don't mind, man, I'd like to know a little bit about your history, like growing up as a Dodger fan and your pops, and just kind of living that messy environment, because nobody else has ever been in your shoes. There's nobody that's probably listening to this podcast that has to be able to tell this shit that you grew up every single day. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh, man. So, grew up, my dad, from LA area. So sports, you know, I was like, he didn't force me to like anybody, but you know, he influenced it. So like, you know, Dodger, Lakers.
When you're watching the game every day and shit, your son's going to be next to you, yeah. you know,
used to listen to a lot of games, dude. I used to like listening to baseball is dope. I love listening to games. It's cool. Especially like, dude, I grew up listening to Vin Scully.
Yeah.
So he was really cool.
You know, it's funny about listening real quick. My boy, shout out to my boy Carlos. I was paying $5 a month to listen to every Yankee game because I was like, fuck that. I'm not going to pay the fucking MLB package, like $25 a month or whatever that is. And then Carlos gave me his login, so now I'm able to watch. But yeah, that's what I'm saying.
MLB
listening, like listening to this podcast, people can get a real, we'll try to draw out a picture and you'll be, but listening. You like use your imagination. It's a completely different thing than
watching
something,
right?
So that's why I really want to talk about this because you know what I mean. You did that a lot.
Yeah, listen to a lot of games. So here's something that's fucking kind of different. didn't grow up with the TV in my house. I always had books. I was always reading books and playing and shit like that. Never spent any time watching TV.
And a lot of people out there are going to be like, this fucking weirdo.
Right.
Why didn't you guys have any TVs?
Just because, you know, there's so many other things to do. And like, my parents' whole thing with it was there's a lot of shit on there, you know, that they didn't want us seeing as kids. So that's why we never, well, as a kid, I didn't have one. And then, you know, later on, got one for fucking PlayStation and shit like that, you know.
Right, right.
So, yeah, like me, I was doing a lot of books and stuff like that. So grew up doing, you know, I was an outdoors kid playing music. Grew up, my parents were avid churchgoers, you know, they would go to church a ton, sent me to private school, which was a Christian school. It was really small too. So I went to a really small Christian school. Man, like compared to it, definitely like tiny compared to like your regular high school. But the cool thing was you got a bunch of attention and stuff, you know, so like, you know, you go to public school and, one thing, that wasn't, a factor was that with us was we weren't just pushed through, you know, school. Like, you know, you get a lot of, students who are just pushed through the system and stuff like that, where
we pass this test, you'll be all right.
Yeah. Yeah. My school, you had to pass with an 80. So if you had a 79, you failed, which is what, a C plus maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, we had to do that. And it was a Christian school. So like in the mornings there was like prayers and like devotions and stuff like that. There's a lot of biblical influence in it. So that's how I grew up, my high school and some of my middle school years.
Hey, your parents are, very nice people.
Yeah, man. They're really, some of the best people, you know, and that's the reason why I am who I am, is because of my family. And you know, like, they're all about family. So here's one thing about me, and I noticed, like, I'm just a sucker, dude. If you put family behind anything, I'm for it, you know. Like, for instance, dude, here's one thing. So like, banana fam, right? My gym fam, I'm all about that shit, bro. Like, you put fam in there, I'll sell out, bro.
You know what's awesome is you probably throwing this out there in the universe, so you're probably doing this a lot, but I don't really think about it like that. But I always say when I like have meal, I'm like, what up, Messy Crib fam?
Yeah,
like,
man.
I don't really use that. I don't ever type that. But for some reason, when I really think about something where I'm closely connected to people, I do use the word fam. And it's crazy that you talk about that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know what? My thing is just to fucking, you know, make people comfortable around me, you know? Even before I was teaching and stuff, you know, as a teenager, I wanted to be genuine, wanted people to feel comfortable, you know, and that's, I mean, it's crazy because I was taught that, but unfortunately not everybody's like that. You know, you get a lot of people who put up walls and are reserved for their own reasons, which is cool, but you know, that's just how I am. And you know, like, I'm open.
And a lot of people, they get fucked up when they're children.
Yeah.
That's why it trips me out to talk to you, because, like, this is one of the questions I've been dying to ask you. Like, I don't have it written down, but I just been having nailed in my fucking head since the minute I thought about talking to you was, your mom's so nice. Your parents are amazing. They support you. I can imagine how much of a backbone your family is to you. You seem like you're really fucking, like, you guys are really, really close. A lot of, like, influential people, like, oh, my mom's my backbone. But with the MMA fighter, like, when did you, like, were you an angry child? You came from, like, you came from this amazing place. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, how the fuck become a cage fighter? You know what,
that's something all my friends always tell me is, like, we never would have fucking imagined this. Like, maybe the military, you know, to get in, get out, do some school and stuff like that, but not fight. I had, it's funny, but in February, I had ran into a friend, and he's like, dude, I never would have imagined you doing this. And I was like, right? And he was like, the only time, he's like, remember that one time you were being mean to, and he just named somebody. And I was like, what? And he's like, yeah, bully. No one knew. He's like, yeah, no one. He was like, he used it as a joke. He's like, yeah, neither can I. He's like, that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't, like, just,
that's awesome.
Know, I couldn't picture you doing it. But yeah, man, I fucking, you know what's crazy is I've never liked anything longer than like 6 months, bro. Doing hobbies and stuff, I just lost, you know, my attention span wasn't there for it. And like when it came to kickboxing, like I just fell in love with it. That's how I started, was kickboxing. So yeah, kickboxing. It's crazy because you would never imagine. I hated fighting, bro. I hated fighting. When I would see street fights and stuff like that, it would turn my stomach. Like, it's just too it was fucking violent to me.
I feel like you hear that pretty consistent with a lot of fighters. Like, yeah. You have your fighters, and then you have like your Rory McDonald's, the intelligent people that are intellectual, and they like, it's a fucking, I mean, everybody's technical. But I'm saying, though, is there's different breeds, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. But everybody fighting, it's so awesome because everybody could do it.
Yeah, anybody can. It's fucking, it's dope. It's something everybody should do too, man. It tells you a lot about you. It gives you a lot of heart, especially for kids and teenagers, man. It puts in, if you get to the right spot and they're good at, you know, producing and giving those kids a good work ethic.
I think I talked about this on the podcast, but what I think is awesome about MMA and like sports in general is like, when you get, I remember when my freshman year, I got taken to my breaking point, like where you teach someone like, oh no, you could push weight. You're only at 50% right now. You could push way past this.
Yeah.
Like you got to learn your limits.
That mental fortitude's insane, man.
And MMA, I feel like wrestlers, those are like some of the strongest, those motherfuckers, like their mental capacity, like they like, God damn.
Yeah.
Like wrestlers, like they say, that's one of the best foundations and all this good stuff. And MMA fighter is just like, that's why I love to talk about your mental health.
Teaches them to work hard.
Yeah. And you can't. And if you don't work hard, you can get your ass whipped.
Yeah.
Like, so the like, realest consequences.
Yeah. Yeah, man. Wrestling's a great thing for kids.
So
too,
when did it trigger you? When did you like, oh, I like fighting?
You know, I
did
just,
you ever get into fights when you were younger?
I got into like two. The first fight I ever got in was elementary, and my dad made me do it. My dad made me do
dad.
It, bro.
That's
yeah.
A great
so,
American
so my,
dad
my,
for you.
My dad used to box and stuff like that. He was a really good boxer. My dad had like 14 fights and was being scouted for like the 84 Olympics, I think.
Oh, shit.
Like 14 fights. He was just really good. Came out of a good Fontana boxing club. Really good boxing gym. Anyway, so what had happened was I was being bullied in like second grade at school. And you know how, well, like my dad, he just had that intuition, you know, I'd go home and I'd be sad or some shit and he'd be like, hey, what's up? And I just, nothing, you know, I was just different. And, he'd be like, what's the matter? You have a bad day at school? We'd start asking questions and eventually find out what's going on.
I feel like your dad operates on a different vibration.
How so?
I don't know. I feel like he has like a, not that there's an aura around him, but I feel like not that he knows something that we don't, but I just feel like he, like, not to sound weird.
No, dude, it's funny because I'm going to tell you what, I'm going to tell you
like
something.
What you're telling me right now,
shit.
I'm like, I feel like he has
it's
that.
It's just parent intuition, I guess, you know, like, I don't have a kid. I don't know what that's like.
Yeah, I know. You know?
Dude, so it's funny though, because you're saying like, he'd be knowing something that we don't know. Like my dad, when he first started, like, when I introduced him to MMA, he'd be like, oh, this guy's going to win. And I'd be like, what are you talking about? Dude, you don't know. You don't even know about MMA. How are you going to just, he's like, yeah, dude, this guy's going to win. You should bet on him. Fucking like 100% of the time, this dude's right. I swear, dude, I need to take him to Vegas or some shit. Yeah, man. So anyways, it's come up from school and I eventually tell him, you know, like, dude, I'm getting bullied and stuff. And I was a church kid, you know, like, I'm not going to fucking fight. You know what I mean?
I don't want to bring that up.
Right? I'm not going to fucking fight. Like, I don't even know how. And anyways, he starts teaching me how to box. He buys some bag gloves is what he bought and some focus mitts and starts showing me how to throw some punches and stuff like that. Didn't show me great shit, but just enough, you know? Anyways, I fucking come home from school one day and the kid's name was Martin. Yeah, man. And he was like a fourth grader or something. He was just a bully at school. Anyways, I go home and I'm going up and I'm just sad, you know. And it just so happens that my fucking dad's home early from work that day. Fucking dad's home early from work the day that I get fucking punked. Right? Anyways, so I walk in the house and my dad's chilling and he's like, hey, what happened? And I was just like, oh, nothing, you know, trying to downplay it like nothing happened. But in my demeanor, I'm over here being all a little sad. And anyway, he's like, Martin picking on you again? And I was like, no. He's like, Martin's picking on you again, huh? And I was just like, yeah, and I'm all crying and shit. He's like, well, we're going to go over there. We're going to fight Martin right now. And I was like trying to not do it because I didn't want to fight. I've never been in a fight in my life. And my dad's like, we're going to go out there. And he grabs me by the hand and fucking yanks me out the door. And we walk down a block where all the kids from school are fucking walking home from school, right? And I told my dad, like, no, he's already home. Like, we're just going to waste our time because I'm trying to get out of a fight. You know, I don't want to do this. And anyways, it's funny because we have this everybody's got the nosy neighbor, right? Well, our nosy neighbor is outside chilling on the fence and stuff. And he watches my dad drag me all the way down, like, 8 or 9 houses down the end of the block to wait where all the kids are, right? And we sit there, bro, until all the kids are done walking. And, like, one of the last 3 kids walking is Martin. And my dad's like, my dad never seen the kid before. My dad don't know the kid, don't know who he looks like, anything. My dad knows who it is for some fucking reason. He's like, go get him. And I was like, no, dad. He's like, go get him. And I was like, no. And the kid, the next you know, the kid's fucking right there and my dad are. And I was just like, hey, Martin. Like, I forget what I told him, but I was like, my dad told me to do something or something. So I just pushed him and the kid decked me. Like, I pushed him, but I didn't even punch him. I pushed him and the kid hit me.
Learned real quick.
Yeah, dude, the kid hit me in the eye and I tagged him like 2 times, 3 times. I don't know. I just hit him. And he left crying and stuff. It was pretty fucking funny. Anyways, I'm all crying, feeling fucking, you know, the adrenaline. And when you're a kid, you can't explain that, you know, and that adrenaline's weird. It's a weird feeling, dude. It's a fucking weird feeling. So I'm crying. You know, I didn't get hit hard. It had like a little shiner or some shit. But I didn't get hit hard and I'm over there crying, bro. Like,
bro, I think that's the best thing. Anybody that hasn't fought before, I think that's the best thing you could explain is when you were a kid and you were so fucking upset.
Yeah, that adrenaline.
Like,
yeah.
And that adrenaline runs through you, yeah. Like, and it's uncontrollable when you're a kid.
You don't know how to control
it. You learn how to, like, okay, control it a bit. But back then.
Yeah, it's different. The first time I felt it, you know, it was just crazy, bro. I didn't know what was happening. So anyways, my dad pulled me back inside the house, and that was that, bro. But the next day at school, bro, that fool was fucking chill as fuck with everybody. Like, they were fucking name-dropping, like, hey, we're going to get Jay on you. We're going to get Jay on you. Fucking, yeah, man.
Your dad knew that was going to happen.
My first fight, bro. My dad made me do it. Shit was fucking
it's fucking awesome.
Scary as shit.
That's it. That's an American tale for you. Of course your dad made you do it.
Right.
That's fucking great.
Yeah, man.
Cheers to fucking dads out there.
All right, that make you fucking fight. Who fucking, isn't that fucking, that's something though. I mean, now fucking I'm teaching kids to fight, dude, for fucking a career and shit. You know, thanks, dad. It's your fault. Right?
That's cool.
Don't ever say you want to be a doctor, bro. You didn't make me go out there and fucking help somebody. Fucking made me go punch some kid in the face.
Oh, bro, you're definitely saving some lives out there. There's a lot of doctors out there that probably go to MMA to get away from all
the
other shit.
We get,
you know what I mean?
We get everybody, bro. We get everybody. Every fucking buddy. It's crazy.
The universe balances itself out.
It really does, dude. It really does.
Yeah, I just being in different professions and meeting so many different people, you really get to know when it's like, oh, you're a normal person too. You have the same issues. They're just different.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like a doctor, I can imagine how stressed out they are just to go do jiu-jitsu for an hour, like once or twice a week probably just is the best thing on earth.
Yeah, man.
People get
it really
dude, Anthony Bourdain, fucking God rest his soul, whatever God you believe in, and that guy, he had one of the most interesting fucking lives on this planet, and he got addicted to jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that, it's got to tell you something.
Yeah.
That's why I'm kind of scared to get into jiu-jitsu because I have bad knees, and I'm like, oh, fuck, what if something... But
it'd probably help it.
Well, see, that's what I was thinking, too. It would help it, but then I was like, you're just making a lot of excuses, bro.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You just don't want to fall. Because I don't have an addictive personality, but I feel like jiu-jitsu is the type of thing where I would just like, I want to be there all day, every day.
Yeah. Dude, you know, it's addicting for me, dude.
That's what I think it's about MMA addictive. Fighters when you were like, you know, I just kept getting better and better. And I feel like with MMA, like, there's not really a ceiling. So, like, you just kind of constantly just.
Just keep pushing, keep getting better. No matter how good you are, there's always someone better than you.
Well,
you
let me ask you a question. If you know what I mean? Asking, what's your jiu-jitsu belt or what is your?
So in jiu-jitsu, I'm a 3rd degree purple belt. So degrees are the little stripes you get. Three stripe purple belt. I've done a bunch of no-gi. So I've done no-gi for about 10 years. The gi was just never appealing to me. And I don't like, no one likes to feel fucking like they're suffocating. That's how I feel when I'm in a gi. Or that's how I used to feel when I'm in a gi. Or when I was in the gi at the time. So I've really started doing it maybe like 2 years ago in a gi. But it's helped my game a ton. I was in denial, like, oh, I don't need it, but it's really helped my game a lot. So yeah, I got a purple belt in jiu-jitsu, and then where I started kickboxing out of, we used to have a belt system there. So in kickboxing, there aren't really any belts.
That's why I was like, jiu-jitsu? Yeah, I don't really know
if,
what else.
If there are belts in a system, it's like a gym thing. There's not a universal belt system for kickboxing. The former gym I used to go to, which, by the way, like, I just lucked out on going there with the coaches they had. The coaches were all K-1 fighters, and they were good coaches, like, great-ass coaches.
That's the best kickboxing. That's about as cream
yeah,
of the crop.
The most prestigious stage for kickboxing. So I had K-1 coaches. They implemented a belt system, and I left that gym, and I was 2 belts away from getting a black belt.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, from them. And I just kind of like gave up on that idea. And then last year we were like, well, we need to implement a system at our gym for, you know, because it's a good way for people to gauge on their progress.
And it's training partners.
Yeah. So we were like, me and my coach were talking about implementing one. And we got on the subject. He was like, well, how long were you doing it for? He knew, but he was trying to see, like, what my rank was and stuff like that. And I didn't catch on because I'm just dumb. You know?
Like most
I'm
of
just
us.
Wanting to talk fucking MMA and fighting and stuff, you know. And I told him, and then I didn't even consider anything. I was just like, yeah, we'll get the black belt. You know, he's got a black belt in from like one of the like martial arts associations out here in America, which is prestigious. I figured, you know, he's going to rank everybody. That's what I figured. And so we're doing the ceremony, and we start giving out all our ranks to the people. I was giving out all the ranks. And then we switched from the kickboxing promotion to the jiu-jitsu promotion. And, we all, like, one of the things that's funny is at our promotions, like, the belts are, like, kind of put off to the side. So we all kind of get these ideas, like, oh, there's a blue belt. This person gets his blue belt. Oh, there's a brown or a black belt. This guy's going to get his black belt. You know, we don't ever know if you are. We just kind of assume. And we see a black belt up there. And we're like, what the fuck is getting a black belt? Ain't no one getting a black belt. Just the extra black belt in there. So after they do all the fucking, the jiu-jitsu belts, and then they're like, yeah, Franklin was like, yeah, I want to have one black belt to give away, and it's not for jiu-jitsu. And I still wasn't even thinking about it. So he started describing all these things that I fucking do, you know, with people at the gym and with the fighters. And, like, dude, it was one of the most, like, surreal moments ever. You know, I've been doing kickboxing since, like, the end of 2005.
It's like winning Grammy.
Dude, it felt better, bro. Like, I'm not even gonna lie, I was fucking so emotional. Like, it was crazy shit. Like, I didn't expect it at all.
You hear people talking, you see it on videos on in YouTube and shit, when people get their black belts and they're just blown away.
Yeah.
It's like they graduated college.
Dude.
So it's so many more years. Like it's more it's, than college. It's like getting your doctorate.
Yeah, man. And you know, like so there's certain people, you know, you figure some people, the turnover rate I think is like 2 to 4 years for martial artists, like in jiu-jitsu and kickboxing. And then you get people who you could tell are going to make it longer than that. And then you get these people who you could just tell they're going to do it forever. And we call those lifers.
The Jake Shields, the Damian Mayas.
Yeah, man. You see that. You just see it in people's eyes, you know. Like, I have kids where I'm like, God damn, dude, this kid's got that fire already. Or teenagers or even adults. Like you could see when that fire starts to ignite in them. And you're like, oh, man, like... Good for you, you know, like, because martial arts, it's a beautiful thing, man. It's a real beautiful thing, you know. So anyways, yeah, I got my black belt in kickboxing and working on my black belt in jiu-jitsu now, you know, gi and stuff like that. I want it. My skill set's there, desire and passion, the drive's there, you know, everything I need for it. So now it's just put in the time and get that bad boy, you know?
That's fucking so, dope, yeah, man. Dude. You guys are fucking grinders. That's something that I think every MMA fighter you could describe about their personalities.
Yeah, man. The mental fortitude's amazing, bro. That shit's amazing. It's crazy. I was I just recently read a book called The World's Fittest Man. I don't know if you watched the podcast with Joe Rogan and Ross Edgley. He's a dude who swam across all of the fucking UK.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So anyways, this dude did it. I think he was swimming like 6 hours at a time. So he's swimming 12 hours a day, 6 hours at a time. And he was talking about the just various athletes and their mental fortitude. And he was talking about how MMA is fucking like it blows his mind too. Yeah, but he's a, like some sports scientist and stuff like that. Really cool book. It's fun to read and stuff like that. But yeah, he was talking about it too. But it trips me out too, man. It trips me out when I see guys just like pushing so hard on like little to no food or little to no water for days. And you're just like, damn, you feel bad. Or like, how do you do this? You know, and I've done it several times, but still, like, I'll be like, how are you doing this, man? I fucking, was it not too long ago, I went and I had this dude fighting for the first time, Jose, and his first fight, and he's cutting to 55, not even a big cut. He's a small dude, but he'd never done it before, and he had, like, 2 pounds left to do, and he was just dying on it. He was just dying. It took him to run, like, 2 miles, had him in the sauna for 20 minutes, then we did a couple rounds on the pads and then put him back in the sauna, back in the pads, had to make weight like that. But he was dying. He was in the sauna, and at the fight we were laughing at him. So it was same day weigh-ins for amateurs. He was like, coach, he was like, coach, I'm sorry, I was being a little bon earlier, because he was like, coach, in the sauna, he's like, I don't think I can do it. He's like, I just don't feel good. He's like, I don't know if I have any more to give. He's like, I'm not sweating that much. You know, like once you're dehydrated, you stop sweating as much. But he has plenty of fat, you know, and his water intake was good.
let me ask you a question real quick. When you are cutting that, because some people will cut like 10 pounds, like, you know, like the day before. And it can get pretty crazy.
Fucking, I heard, I don't know which one of the Lima brothers, whichever one's a champ.
Douglas Lima, probably.
Yeah. Damn it. That he cut about 30 pounds. About 30 pounds in 12 hours. And it's different if you're a big guy compared to a little guy. Like Tito Ortiz, 20 pounds, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, however long they do it, right? The big guys. Because they have more fat, they have more to give than the little guys when they start getting down in those lower numbers. So
yeah, because you've heard about it, like TJ Dillashaw, you heard of Henry Cejudo, a lot of these guys that fight at the 125 135, those guys, like, dude, like, I feel like I'm gonna die.
Yeah,
that's what I wanted to ask you, like, how have you ever felt like to the point where you've cutting and you're just like, oh, like the guy's like, I have nowhere to give because I'm literally like, I think I'm gonna pass out, I'm gonna die.
Oh fuck yeah, dude. The pass out thing, you know, it could be dangerous. You got to be really careful about it, you know.
I think in the future they're going to do away with weight. Or maybe not do away with weight classes, but there's going to be
a way. You know what my idea is? And it's a little crazy, but it would be dope. Is who cares about the weight? What if they just matched everybody from 5'6 to 5'8 against each other?
That would be pretty crazy, because you get like a Pat Barry that's a heavyweight. The dude's like 5'10", but he's a fucking tree trunk.
But then he would be fighting guys from like 5'9 to 6 foot. So then it's up to you at what you want to fight, your weight. It's just your size. So then you wouldn't get this 6 footer who's fighting 155 pounds because he weighed in 155, fighting at fucking 200 pounds.
Yeah, I know.
You know, 185.
Like Yoel Romero, like, how do you get to 185? You look like you're 250.
Fuck.
That, like, you got muscles on top of fucking muscles.
Right? He got six packs on his head, on his
ears.
And
the dude, and the dude's from Cuba, and they say he's only like 40 years old. It's crazy,
right? That's fucking some fucking funny shit. Yeah, yeah, man. Do you still go up to fights?
Yeah, man. I actually just let everybody know. I'm glad you mentioned that. Well, not to let everybody, I don't give a fuck, but we're going to go see Cormier versus Miocic.
Oh, yeah, yeah. That's what I was asking. That's local. Yeah.
We already got our tickets.
Did you? That's dope, dude.
That card is fucking stacked. I'm so fucking excited, man.
I'm excited for the Anthony Pettis fight.
Oh, no. Nate Diaz. Yeah, that shit's going to be sick.
The whole UFC experience, I heard, is dope. I've never been to one.
You know, that's crazy. I've never been to one. You know, I think we talked about this before. I've been to about five UFC fights. I've been to a bunch of title fights. And the first time I went, my cousin was like, dude, I think he went to see, like, GSP versus Josh Koscheck. Like, when none of them were that, like, GSP wasn't the champ. It was way back in the day. Fucking Renato. So, I'm gonna
Babalu.
Dude, he was like, dude, you got to see this guy. He put fucking, he choked out the little heathen, or not the little heathen, that's fucking Jeremy Stevens, but something heathen, I think his name was like something heathen, oh whatever, okay? Mm-hmm. His last name was Heathen. Dude choked him out, and like I think he hated him or some shit, and he held it too long, that's why they kicked him out of the UFC.
Really?
My cousin was at that fight, and he told me, and I was like, all right, I'll go. And I forgot the first fight I went to, but it was a Cain Velasquez fight. And I think Randy Couture's on the card, bro. I even see, dude. I seen Cain Velasquez fight four times. I seen him out fucking Brock Lesnar when he fucking did a little fucking breakdancing and shit.
Yeah.
That's one fight I wanted Daniel Cormier to get, was that Brock Lesnar fight. He would have got paid and he would have fucked. I think that would.
I just like watching Brock because he's such a freak show, you know.
He's
just
a beast.
I don't,
and he's a legit wrestler. That's what's cool, is that he's a legit, like he's a legit Olympian, high school, I mean college, you know.
Yeah.
So it's cool. Like it's like, it's not like a CM Punk. Like get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. He's got skills. Yeah, man. That's fucking that's dope, man. I never like I said, I've never been to a UFC event. I've been to all the other fight shows, from like boxing to kickboxing to the other animations, but I've just never been to UFC.
It's like going to Disneyland versus a fucking Scandia.
Dude, that's what I hear, man.
It's a lot. You know what's crazy, bro? One of my first fights that I fucking went to, I dropped some fucking ecstasy.
For a fight?
I fucked up. Dude was like, hey, I got some extra ecstasy, you down? We parted the night before and we didn't take it. And we're like, fuck it, I'll just take it right now. So we took it before the fight. I was in my seat just hating life. Hearing the music just loud, because the music's loud as fuck. And it was awesome. But
where were you at? What show? Or where was it?
It was at the MGM.
Oh, okay.
I've been to the Mandalay Bay once and the MGM three times. See fights.
Dope.
And at the MGM, when I was hearing the music and shit like that, like it would stop, and then the fights, because you know you don't hear the commentators.
No,
and I didn't realize that. You know, I'm a regular fucking fanboy.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh okay, this is my first. Like we're just watching fights. Like that's all you're doing. And so I'm here on ecstasy, fucking like trying to get out of my chair and shit. And then I hear my first leg kick. It's like whack, and I was like, oh, like dude, I didn't feel it, of course.
Yeah.
But like just being, you know, just so in the moment connected, dude, I was like, oh damn, this is real. Like I'm really fucking here. And that's when it brought me like, oh, leg kicks. And I think I saw Forrest Griffin leg kick a radio host, and he like broke his fucking leg, and like I think the dude passed out because he got kicked so fucking hard. And so that's what I really fell in love. Like I was like, oh, I'm watching every fight, I'm never gonna miss shit. And I mean, you know me for a long time, so like, dude, I don't miss a UFC.
And
there's a fucking one every weekend these days. You know what I'm saying? And so when I see
UFC
you fight like
pass.
If it works, like it's my birthday, and you know you were gonna fight on Saturday, and I was supposed to go out to Mexico this week, and I was like, you know what, let's do a few different things. And I'm not saying I changed my whole schedule, you know what I'm saying, but I was like, you know, we're gonna make it a birthday weekend down there, and I'm gonna be like, Jay's fight on Saturday, like this shit's gonna be dope, like you know what I'm saying. And it's just I don't say like it runs my world, but dude, it's like baseball, football, and MMA.
Yeah, it's fun, man.
Like it's literally become that.
It's so entertaining, man.
Like, and when you really get into it, you really get into like the real MMA fans. Like we don't know shit about jiu-jitsu. But we'll sit there and see these motherfuckers like a goddamn chess piece.
Yeah.
And you know, you kind of know after watching Rogan and explain it for so long, you kind of know what's going on. You kind of see what's happening.
Yeah,
you know, you've never done it.
Definitely. But even if you don't know, like there's spots that you just know another
like,
dude's
whoa!
In trouble. Yeah. Or like, how did they do that? Like, dude, that shit's amazing.
When you see a guy get out of a choke and the crowd goes fucking wild. Yeah. And it's like, holy shit, dude, these guys are so resilient. Like, and the guys that don't tap, it's like, of course they don't tap. They've been fucking killing themselves for 8 fucking weeks.
Yeah.
They don't want to just give up, you know? And that's crazy.
It's fucking insane, man.
That's just fucking crazy. Amazing, man.
I remember one thing that like really, like I've been to a ton of fights, even before.
Yeah, I'm over here talking like a fanboy, but I can imagine in your shoes.
No, same thing though. I'm a fan. I'm a fucking fan. And like, I'm not going to lie, like maybe the last 2-3 years, I've kind of like stopped going to fights as much, just because there was so many for me. So I was going to fights to corner, competing, and then watching UFC, and then all these other fights, you know, friends fighting other shows. I remember one of the craziest things that I ever heard at a fight show was Crow Cop kicking somebody. Like, I've heard the baseball bat, you know, someone getting hit and it sounds like a baseball bat hitting a ball. But when he was kicking at this, I think it was Glory, and he's fighting Big Baby Miller. Dude, he was kicking the dude so hard, and I was ringside. So you hear things great, and dude, it was like someone was clapping. Right? But that thud behind it, fuck, like right in front of me.
And you're talking about, yeah, and you're talking about Franklin's legs.
Oh, fuck.
Fucking right. Crow Cop's fucking, yeah, legs. Those things are like, right, fucking, what do they call those at the Yosemites? Fucking sequoia trees.
Right. Fucking tree trunks and shit. Yeah, man. I fucking, that shit was crazy. I was like, holy fuck. Like, how did that guy, like, not get chopped in half? Like, goddamn. Fucking brutal. Brutal. That shit.
I remember
was
watching you know where I was at. I seen a Gonzaga knock out Crow Cop with a head kick.
Yeah, that was a
seen that live, and then I seen it on video, and I was like, oh my god.
That's a sick ass plot twist, right? Like, weren't you supposed to knock the other guy out? Fuck. That's crazy too, how he folded over. Like, that's one of the craziest things ever.
Yeah, and you know what's crazy too is they get set up like MMA is so different, because boxers, okay, I grew up a Cesar Chavez fan. I named our fucking Messy Crib mascot off of the greatest Mexican fighter to ever fucking Caesar live. But, like, boxers, you know, they set up, they do their feints, they do different shit and shit like that, and it's their hands, and I know it's one of probably the oldest sports, and Mayweather is fucking great, whatever. But MMA, dude, you set that shit up with your hands, and then all of a sudden a question mark kick comes over your shoulder and just right, lays you the fuck out? Yeah. Some Zohan shit?
Right?
Like, bro. Yeah,
right. I thought you were going to hit my leg.
Like, that's a completely different story.
Yeah, man. That shit. Dude, so I have this, he's 14. His name's John. This kid's been training with me since he's like 8. And he's in my adult class now, and he's, you know, he's got, fucking, he's amazing. His skills are amazing, but he don't hit like a man yet because he's young. But I'll have him spar with like grown dudes, you know, and he fucking beats them up. It's just so funny because he's so young, you know, and these dudes are sitting there like thinking like, oh, I'll work this kid, and fucking John's got a fucking like great ass question mark kick. So they're thinking they're gonna get kicked, and we do this look low, fake low, look low, kick high, and so he'll look low, so they're thinking he's gonna kick him in the leg, and then bam, right across the face. It's fucked up, but it's so funny, man, because he's 14 years old, and they come in, you know, like thinking like, oh, he might be doing it longer, but I'm a man, I'll beat him up. Good luck.
Technique always wins.
Yeah, good luck.
What does,
man,
Connor say, like, time versus precision always beats power or some shit like that?
Timing beats speed.
Yeah,
precision beats like power. I don't remember, yeah, what he said. Yeah, shit. Yeah, man. So yeah, that's fucking, it's pretty funny, man. Kids are fucking,
they're all we got.
Amazing. Yeah, dude, you know,
we gotta try to teach what we know, right?
It's important, man. How long have you been coaching kids?
You know, man, since I was 19, so what's that, 32 years? 12 years.
Yeah,
yeah,
damn.
I coached I remember I coached my first freshman team, and my boy was a wrestling coach also, so I kind of like had the whole team to myself, and the next year I actually had the whole team to myself. Uh-huh. And it was awesome, man. And every time I've ever had it, we've never had, like, the most talent. I've always coached, well, you know, a lot of Mexicans. So, you know, right, it's always about technique and fundamentals.
Yeah.
That's why I appreciate MMA, because you could see the guy that, like your last fight, that fucking guy went out there swinging like crazy. And you were just, like, just dodging some punches. And then, boom, just tag him, back up, you know, let this guy go crazy. And then, yeah, boom, and it's like, oh, shit. And that was a real work of art. Your last fight, I fucking loved it. That was amazing. That was a real, real good experience.
Yeah. Yeah, man. It's fucking definitely takes a lot of work to get to like that level where you just stay calm and like you see the barrage. Cause I watched the video, and like sometimes like I'm really passive, and it kind of like translate into my fighting game. Like I'll be like, okay, he hit me two times, I'm going to catch him in like a couple seconds. Instead of being like, no, right away, get it, bam, bam, score those points back.
Fight emotionally. And
yeah, so like sometimes like I watch that video and I'm like, God damn it, I should have fucking did something while I was doing that, because it's almost making me look bad, even though I know that he's not hitting me. The crowds over here seeing him punch, and even though I'm blocking, are like absorbing out of my shoulders and stuff. They're probably like, oh, he's getting beat up. And
yeah, I was watching, I was like, well, Jay hasn't got hit in the face one time yet. I was like, this guy's throwing a lot, he's going crazy.
I won't say I don't like to stay in the pocket, but I like to stay in the pocket. You know, like I like to be there. and I don't mind being swung on, because I know how to roll with the punches. So for instance, I'm getting punched and it's gonna hit, like I'll move enough to where I'm not absorbing it all. So I don't mind that, but to the judges that looks bad. You know, like I'll absorb one and I'll give you one that you're going to eat completely, you know, or I'll let you throw five and I'm going to land two or three and you're going to miss all four of yours or all five of yours. And sometimes that looks bad to the judges. Like I say, I'm passive, but, so I've been working, that's one thing I've been working on my game, is like getting those points right back if they're scoring. And being smart about it though, like obviously not exposing myself and stuff, you know? So, yeah.
Hell yeah. So, before I get punched in the face, Jay, I appreciate you, brother. I fucking love you, man. I really appreciate you spilling your fucking guts out, really talking like the ins and outs of really what happens. And it's so much fucking more in MMA fighters. I really bow down to like you guys, just because you're literally teaching a different language.
It is.
You guys are out there and you're putting your heart and soul. You literally could, like, I don't think anybody's ever died from MMA, but dude, I feel like when you go in that cage, you're literally like, I could die. Like, right. Kind of feel like how you guys would think. Like, I don't think we talked about when you look at the other guy at the other side of the cage, like what goes through your fucking head.
Yeah.
But I would think like, oh, this is like kind of like life or death. I'm here to fuck you up. Like, I'm sorry, bro, but
people get some weird things going. You know, other people are like really like, some common things like, oh, I'm trying to get paid, I'm gonna win. Other people, like I had a coach, like, dude, when I go out there, I just imagine this dude telling me that he's gonna like rape my mom and my sisters and all the females I love. I was like, God damn, bro. Like, for reals. You know?
It's probably what an average person would think an MMA fighter would think.
Right? Nah, but like, you know, I go out there and I'm like, dude, I'm about to, like, whatever this dude has, like, I know I have something for him. You know, whatever he has, I have something for him. So I'm really confident when I go out there and like that aspect.
And that goes behind your work ethic and you train and you know you're prepared. Because there's a difference when you walk out there and you're like, I'm sure you went to a fight before where you weren't prepared.
Like, oh, like, shit. Yeah, I've had a couple of oh shit moments. Like, I should have trained harder. You know, dude, that fight I got kicked in the balls, that guy was actually working me. He was working me. He was so big. And I used to fight a lot heavier too. So he was like 6'2", 6'3". I'm 5'7". This dude had like a 12-pack, bro. Like a 12 pack, and I'm sitting there like I'd fight with my shirt on just because they were so buff, you know. I'm a little fucking fat kid, and I just took the fight just on short notice. I'm like, yeah, I'll fucking fight, I don't care, I'm fat, like I train all the time, I'm in the gym but not training for a fight. And went in there and he was beating me up, and my out was I got kicked twice in the ball. I couldn't continue though. Like, there was no way I could continue that.
I don't, half the time when I see them get hit, I'm like, ooh, like, how is this guy even standing?
Yeah, he hit me hard those two times, bro. Like, I was puking, and they were just like, they called it off, you know. So, yeah.
That's pretty intense.
It's crazy, man. It's crazy. And for me, it's not just a sport, you know. It's a lifestyle, and it has to be, you know. I want to compete with the best. You know, so I got to live it, you know, so that means, you know, not doing a lot of things, not attending a lot of events, you know, when I'm in camp, or sometimes just taking a day off from doing all that stuff to let my body recover or get some extra training in, you know. So it's definitely a lifestyle, and it's not hard by any means, but sometimes it's not easy either, you know, like when you're in fight camp and you're struggling, like, you know, your best friends, everybody's going to go party or do some fun shit, something that you'd like to do, and you're sitting there aching, you know, and you have to go to training the next day, and you can't fucking eat your favorite food, you can't eat pizza, you can't fucking eat a burrito, a burger, you know, and you're just sitting there eating your fucking piece of broccoli.
Your piece of broccoli.
You know, something like that, you know, like there's no fucking comfort in anything. You know, so like that part gets tough, man. And then knowing that you're sore and you got to go back the next day and do it for fucking another, however long you're training, you know?
Yeah, no, I mean, I see it, bro. We had a great time here. You know, I took a few dabs and I had some good time. And I see yeah. You're over there sipping on that NutriShop drink.
Fucking BCAs.
So, you know, I really, you guys are fucking awesome. And I really tip my hat to you guys because there's a lot of fucking dedication. You're some of the messiest motherfuckers out there. And, you know, you're the second MMA fighter, you know, just due to our schedules. You know, you weren't first, but, you know what I'm saying? But yeah. You guys, I'm going to definitely have a lot more. And I can't wait. And hopefully I can talk to you guys and we can get something going at the gym.
Yeah. We'll have to do like a part two, you know?
Yeah, I know, for sure. Yeah, for sure.
Part two. Getting like some music shit, some other live shit.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about drums. What the fuck? We both love drums. Right. Like, that's one of our biggest passions.
Yeah. That's fucking funny. I seen, you know, the little gifts on like social media and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah.
So I seen one today because I was texting one of my lady friends who I'm dating, and she's like, I want to punch something or somebody. And I was like, well, better not be me because I'll take you down. And she's like, I'll figure out a way to beat you. And then I found
bitch,
one of
no, you won't.
Basically, so I found a little gif on the phone, and it was like, remember from Hot Rod? I think Frank, he's all in the bed and like Hot Rod's all fucking goes up to him and tells him he's gonna beat his ass. And the dad's like, you couldn't beat a drum. So I sent that to her. It was so perfect.
Oh, that's fucking great.
Yeah, man. We'll have to fucking get on that stuff. But yeah, man, drums fucking dope, bro.
For sure. Anything else you'd like to talk about or you'd like to say, brother? Anybody else you'd like to thank that you didn't think about earlier?
Shit. Fucking thank you to fucking the Messy Crib, Messy Nation. Fucking y'all keep it real. Fucking JR, thank you, man. Show's dope. Fucking hope you get some good people onto this fucking season, man.
Hell yeah,
fucking
bro.
Fucking give a Messy fam fucking what they want to hear.
Hell yeah, we got motherfucking Jasta. We finally, guys, this is a fucking treat. We finally got him in the goddamn Messy Crew. But everybody out there, I just want to say thank you guys for listening again. Go follow Jasta. Go check him out on Instagram, Facebook, J Pinto. He's a fucking nice guy. And, dude, fucking get to know your MMA fighters out there. These guys are fucking amazing. Yeah, they're not as scary as you think. Nah. These guys are probably some of the most intellectual, smart fucking people that you can actually have a real fucking conversation. Because your ego's got to be pretty fucking small to put it all out there in front of fucking a lot of people.
Yeah. Especially, very humble, you know, just people. Training, bro. Like, that's one of the things, too, is like,
yeah.
You know, there are people who do have fucking massive egos. But, like, dude, for the most part, you get people... And there shouldn't be ego, you know, because fucking, dude, you'd fucking end up.
Everybody's going to get humbled.
Bad situation.
Like MMA, you pretty much everybody gets humbled.
Fuck yeah. Man.
But yeah, so if you're looking to train MMA or if you're looking to do anything with MMA, hit up my boy Jay. He's got you. He can, you know, and go check out his fights and the Gearing Fighting System. Thank you guys so much, you know, and for being there. And I fucking love those guys over there. They're fucking amazing. And it's the real, it's like the first time I've ever been able to actually interact with like some people like outside of just being a fanboy.
Yeah.
So, you know,
whenever, man, you want to come down, you know, we got you, man.
Whenever I stop making excuses. Well, I'm going to stick to yoga for now.
Yoga's hard, bro.
I love
Yoga's
it.
Yoga's hard.
I'm fat, so I don't really like to run.
What type of yoga are you doing?
My favorite, the hardest thing I've ever done was hot yoga for an hour and a half.
Fuck.
But I do an hour of yoga pretty much about 5 days a week.
There you go. That's good, dude. That's healthy. That's
yeah,
healthy.
No, it definitely, I sweat my ass off, and I'm definitely the fattest person there usually. But there's a lot of hot fucking
bro,
moms.
You in the back of the room watching all the moms.
Hell no, I'm in the front, bro. I got ass, bro.
Position.
I'm trying to find any of these MILFs that'll be like, ooh, that guy has a nice ass. All right, there's some long hair. I might want to pull it. No, I'm just kidding. But thank you, everybody out there. Go check out Proline Collision, our sponsor. Any kind of auto parts, any kind of auto needs, anything like that, and go check out Classick Sports, guys. Appreciate you guys for listening. Until next time, bless the mess.
Keep it real, Missy, man. Keep it real.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Peace. And I wonder if I never smoked weed that one time. Took my first tab, spit my first rhyme. Riding on the grind, y'all just riding on the Alpine. Shout out to Jay Mundo, I took that line. Living on the highlights, drinking on some highlights. Thinking about the good times, can I get another line? Wait, wonder if I never did that. Who would I be? Would I still be?
trying to learn how to live. I wonder how easy that it really is. I wonder if they never made Xanax, would the world still be in a rut, depressed? Fuck around and get your whole damn crew reset. Messy motherfucker on the team. Had a messy motherfucker on the team. Cut the beat and hear him speak. Kind of crazy. Would I have anxiety or gain notoriety? Men's society with styles and variety. Would it even matter if I climbed the corporate ladder? Hit it out the park like a cleanup batter. I wonder, what if I grew up in Brooklyn? Could I be like Biggie and Jay? We all got bars, love women, and